Congratulations! You have found the Lambcast, the official podcast of the Large Association of Movie Blogs, also known as the Lamb. The Lamb is the largest collective of online movie blogs and podcasts with 2,000 members and counting. Every week on the Lambcast, various members of the Lamb community get together to talk about our favorite subject, movies. So bookmark the Lamb and follow us on social media. Be sure to join us each week to hear a lively discussion of films and movie-related talk from our members. Join the flock at largeassmovieblogs.com. Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Lambcast. This is episode 717, the first Lambcast recorded in the new year, but we're not quite done with 2023. In fact, this is the capstone episode for 2023. We've gathered together a flock of lambs to share our favorite films of the year in the traditional top 10 format. Last week, we caught up with a lot of films from late November and December, and some of them may show up again today, but we have a new cast of guests for this episode, and we have a much longer period of time to cover, so we expect there to be a wide variety of choices, but also some occasional overlap. As is traditional, when there is overlap, we use the pineapple kiosk rule, which simply means that if somebody has a film that appears higher on their own list, you say pineapple kiosk, and we wait to talk about it until it reaches the highest point on any of the film lists from today's guests. Now, some of you may not have done the list in the top 10 format, but simply took 10 of your favorite films that you saw and included them randomly. But whether you did it alphabetically, chronologically, or you did a ranking, the pineapple kiosk rule will stay in place. Let's meet the lambs who've chosen to join us this week in person, and let me add that we have a couple who've sent us their list to include virtually, and a few who sent me their list so that I could read them out loud. We'll get to those mystery guests after the break. But first up, the actual guests who are with us today. Rishabh Vashishtha has joined us from his site for film, music, and TV reviews, and he's with us back on the show today. Rishabh, welcome back.
Hey, thanks, Richard. Thanks for having me back. Happy New Year, everybody. And does anyone know if that Sandworm movie is coming out this year, finally?
I believe it will be showing up sometime in March. We have an exit question that we're talking about also, and that movie may come up in part of the discussion. Howard Casner from Pop Art does return from last week with a complete collection of films this week, though.
Hello, hello.
Welcome back, Howard. Tony Coogan from the Wicker Man podcast and Coog's Reviews is back to share his perspective. Let's see if Donna the Nugget returns to the show today.
It was an honorable mention. thanks for having me on.
And Latoya at Franglis 27 Tales comes back after a long absence from the show.
Hello, thanks for having me again, and Happy New Year.
We're glad to have you back, and Happy New Year to you as well. All right, folks, so it's pretty straightforward. We're just going to go through our lists. You tell us why you included your film, and anyone who has a comment as we go along is welcome to join in. Rishabh, we're going to start with you. What's your number 10 film or the first film that you wanted to talk about?
All right, guys. My number 10 is, of course, one half of the worldwide sensation in film today. So without, you know, taking too much time to bother an introduction, because I assume there might be some pineapple kiosks. At number 10, I have Barbie. Okay.
It sounds like you're all alone. Okay.
That is interesting. I expected pineapple kiosks as well.
Yep, I guess.
All right. Tell us why you've got Barbie on the list, besides it being the international phenomena that you mentioned.
Yep, exactly. So I put it at number 10. I think that's where I felt it belonged. I mean, I would not say it's perfect, but there's definitely something really fresh going on there. Of course, a big fan of Greta Gerwig, and I think she did a really good job of using this well-known IP to kind of take it further and talk about gender roles and then create this really clever satire of the Barbie world and the real world. And I think it was a high concept movie that didn't basically compromise on its comedy or satirical choices. There's a lot of great zany and meta kind of overtones to it. It's very self-aware. And I really did enjoy the finale of it as well. I think given the tonality of it, it was mostly comedic and a bit more like a pointed satire for a while. But then the kind of dramatic turns that it takes towards its finale and the way that it kind of brings it together in an emotional way, I thought worked fairly well. I think the screenplay is a little bit messy, which is kind of why it comes down to or a little bit of a number 10 for me, despite it being like, I mean, the biggest movie of this year. But I still think thematically and narratively and stylistically that Greta Gerwig and, of course, co-writer Noah Baumbach, they put together something that came together in a surprising way.
All right. Anybody want to comment on Barbie before we move on? Because I've commented before, and I'm willing to comment again, but I want to give other people a chance, too.
I think my issue is that when it comes to gender politics, it wasn't that original. Especially that one last speech that America Ferrara gives. I said, how many times have I heard this speech before? So even though it was fun when it comes to technical aspects of it, it was the same old thing when it came to gender politics. It didn't offer us anything really new. But there were times when it was a lot of fun and just great to look at.
Yes. I was just going to say I'll talk about Barbie as well. I agree that it was very meta. Some of it even more than I thought it would be, with a few in-jokes towards Mattel and also Warner Brothers. So I think that was quite good, where it had that interaction between the Mattel plastic worlds and reality, and how reality may be messy compared to a perfect world that they had in their doll world, but you know, sometimes that may be preferable. So that was quite good as a message. Loved the costumes. The costume design is fantastic, and the set design as well. So much attention to detail I found with that. So those were the elements that I thought were really good for Barbie.
Yeah, I think the production design and the costumes were the best part of the film. I think the meta message kind of misses. I don't want to harp on it too much. This was the most disappointing movie of the year to me. It was a film that I wanted to enjoy and didn't. I saw Oppenheimer, I think, the same week. I didn't do the Barbieheimer thing that everybody was talking about. I didn't see them both on the same day. But Oppenheimer felt a little long, but it was 3 hours. This was 2 hours, and it felt interminable. And I only laughed once or twice. And for a comedy, it needs to, you know, I think it needs to be a little bit lighter. That's me, obviously. I was the outlier in this world, because the rest of the world has embraced this movie and has been very happy with it. And Rishabh liked it well enough to include it in his top 10. Although I won't say I'm pleased, but I'm at least I'm not alone. That I'm not the only person who doesn't have it in their top 10 list. Okay. Well, Howard, what have you got in the number 10 spot for your list?
Well, I chose Paul Schrader's latest existential crisis film about a man who's saved by some sort of spiritual redemption. That's very vague as to what spiritualness it is, but it's The Master Gardener with Joel Egerton, about a man with a Nazi past who provided information to the police in exchange for going into witness protection, and the conflicts he has with his boss and with the boss's, I believe it's niece, but it could be a granddaughter when she arrives. It's both a love story and a story of redemption. I have this soft spot for Paul Schrader's films like this.
You like all that existential stuff,
yeah,
which, you know, I appreciate. Did this get a theatrical release?
Well, it got a theatrical release. I think I may have seen it on streaming, though.
All right, because I don't remember seeing it in theaters, or I don't even know if I heard about it. But I'm interested in seeing it. Joel Edgerton is one of my favorite actors working today. I like him quite well. And, you know, so, and Paul Schrader, he's been hit or miss for me, but I've enjoyed several of his films. I haven't seen some of the most recent ones, though, so I'm a little out of the loop there. Has anybody else seen The Master Gardener? Nope.
I have.
So nobody else can comment. You have?
I have, yes.
How did you feel about it, Latoya?
I thought Joel Egerton was very good in his portrayal, was a protector, but also a man with a violent past. So it's slow paced, but I thought that there was depth to his character and the dynamics between him and his manager at the house and his own interpretation of events as well. I haven't included it on any of my lists, but it's a good watch.
Tony, you're up next. What have you got for us?
Okay, so again, as I've been doing every time I've been on this the podcast, doing my top 10 list, this is my rules is any film that gets a UK release in 2023 was eligible, which will require towards the end of my list. My number 10, and this is one that I kind of expect this will be Pineapple Kiosk, is Godzilla Minus One.
Yeah, Pineapple Kiosk.
Pineapple Kiosk, yes. So we'll come back to that one. All right. Latoya, I know that you weren't going to put them in any particular order, so what's the first film that you want to talk about?
Right. Okay. So, yes, mine are in a random order just in terms of favorites. So just going from the bottom of my list as well is Talk to Me. And this was one of the surprise hits for me for last year. Quite a cerebral horror involving a group of friends and a possessed item that they find, and they all take it in turns to use and feel the effects of it. But aside from the supernatural elements to it, there is a tale that touches upon trauma and grief and friendships and belonging, but also othering as well. So there are a lot of elements involved, which also produce a really compelling dynamic in the film. And there is a superb performance as well from the lead actress, Sophie Wilde. And so that was one of the films that really stood out to me this year as being quite original in its concept.
Let me add, it's also quite scary, which is what it's supposed to do.
Yes, in ways.
And I think you picked out a lot of the things that are the subtext of the film that are really interesting about it. You know, the idea of inclusion and being connected to other people and what people are willing to do to be a part of the group, plus this notion that, you're kind of becoming somebody else as part of this supernatural effect. It's devastating. And the grief thing, it's very sad, but at the same time, it's also confusing. And it seems like it's manipulative from the supernatural perspective too. I like the film really well, but there is a couple of spots there where there's some very explicit violence, and just in case anybody is wondering, you might want to be careful about that. It's perfectly appropriate for this kind of film, but some of you you might want to be aware that some things happen that are not pleasant to watch. Well, I have on number 10 on my list something that's already been Pineapple Kiosk, so we'll get to Godzilla Minus One when it comes up later on somebody's list. Rishabh, we're back to you. What's your number 9 film?
All right, so I'll take a little bit of a cue from the Talk to Me choice and then have my number 9 be a bit of a sci-fi horror last year, I should say. And that would be, in the true Cronenberg world, we have David Cronenberg's Infinity Pool. All right,
Honorable mention for me.
And I should say Brandon Cronenberg. I messed up the first name there out of habit. So Brandon Cronenberg, the son of David Cronenberg, has directed this movie, and this is kind of his follow-up to the 2020 movie Possessor, or the latest one he's done after that. And I was not a big fan of Possessor, to be honest, which kind of made me doubt if I would ever like a Brandon Cronenberg movie. But I have to say, he really impressed me with Infinity Pool. This was a truly, I guess, kind of depraved but interesting sci-fi morality tale, which kind of explores what happens when you go into the depths of human darkness and what happens when you basically take away basically the shackle of consequences from people and law and order ceases to exist. And essentially, without giving too much away, this is a movie about a place where crime is allowed through various means, through a specific method that's quite interesting. And if you're a fan of sci-fi narratives, I'm sure you'll find this quite thought-provoking and interesting. I don't want to give away too much. And basically, you have Alexander Skarsgård and Mia Goth at the center of it, who I think are both really just primed for a movie like this in terms of giving really intense performances in a sci-fi narrative. And I think it goes beyond some of the pulpiness to kind of become a pretty thought-provoking story about class and gender and some of the other kind of themes. And then think the climax and finale, I don't think I'll ever forget Mia Goth's performance. It becomes almost kind of silly, but I think Brandon Cronenberg kind of knows how to land the dialogue and land the scenes to make it still feel really dark and compelling. So for me, number 9 is Nitty Gritty.
All right. Well, Rishabh, you and I could apparently go to the movies together, but then have long conversations afterwards, because this is a film that I despised. I thought it got less interesting as it went along. It's got a ridiculous premise, but I'm willing to go along with that at the beginning because I'm looking for some insight. And it just seemed to go out of control as it went along. I felt less and less engaged with what was being presented here. I got to be honest with you, I haven't thought about it that much since I saw it and despised it and wrote about it a year ago. So, it's not fresh in my mind to remind me. I am a fan of Mia Goth, but I thought that she was mostly wasted in this. And it's disappointing because I thought she was terrific in the two Ty West movies.
All right, Richard, me and you, we're going to the movies very soon.
That's it. And we're going to have coffee afterwards and yak about it quite a bit. There you go. Well, Howard, you stepped out for a minute, but you're back. What's your number 9 film?
Okay, I expect to get Pineapple Kiosk for this. Actually, first I want to say that my list is based on the fact that there are some films I haven't seen. I haven't seen Poor Things, All of Us Strangers, or Zone of Interest. I've read the book Zone of Interest, so I really can't wait to see the film. So my next one is The Holdovers.
Pineapple Kiosk?
Yes.
Yes, you're right. That. You got Pineapple Kiosk. So we'll come back to that later on in the show. Tony, how about you at number 9?
So my number 9 is... Well, first of all, I'm guessing to be a trend of other films that will be on other people's lists for, like, product films this year. And I'm not sure if this one will get panel Kiosk, but my number 9 is BlackBerry.
You're on.
Okay, so, yeah, so we've got the trend.
It's getting very good reviews, so.
Yeah, it's on where...
Honorable mention for me.
Yeah, I think I can't remember who coined the term of it. I think my first heard of it was Wendy Ide, for the Observer, who called it the biopic. It was getting all the product films this year. I'm almost certain that again that another one of the product films is going to be higher up on people's lists. But for me, BlackBerry was the highlight of the year. I feel like what is this? How tight the script is. It's really dark in some places, funny. It's does talk about stock manipulations and all the technology behind the BlackBerry phones in a way that even me as somebody who doesn't really know about those kind of things found really engaging and interesting. The performances from everyone involved are all great. Glenn Howerton is an absolute scene stealer in the film. Every time he's on screen, he's just this great ball of rage that you're just waiting to see explode it in every direction possible. I almost really want to see him work with Armando Iannucci now, give him a Malcolm Tucker style role, which he'd feel like he could really devour. And even small roles that normally characters that wouldn't really be as interested when we get people like Cary Elwes and Michael Ironside to be in the film, then this makes the characters really engaging. Like, there's this great sense of humour to it, even just through the way it's edited and certain cuts. Like, there's one specific zooming at one point, which was one of the biggest laughs I got in any film this year. I don't really want to spoil for anyone who hasn't seen it. And it's... I mean, I found just found it in where beforehand I was thinking, you know, what really drama could you get from the making of a mobile phone? Well, and I just ended up really having a great time with it, laughing all the way through and finding just a great comedy.
Well, I tell you, you know, the great thing about shows like this is that you get a chance to talk about films and hear what other people are seeing. This has not been on my radar at all. I just looked at the IMDb page. I'm going, why has this not been on my radar? This looks like it would be a great movie, something very interesting. And I like your description of it as it being a product film. What was the term you used?
The biopic.
Biopic. There you go. I've got to remember that when I put up the post so that I know exactly who gets credit for
yeah,
that.
Just because, yeah, so when I first heard it from when critic Wendy Eyes. That's where I first heard it.
Well, I like it. I like it. So, but I won't be buying a BlackBerry anytime soon. But I know the concept. Very good. Latoya, what's your next movie?
So my next movie is a Japanese film, and it's the latest Koreeda film called Monster. And this one's quite a powerful tale of childhood told from the perspectives of two young boys at school. Both are slightly different. They gravitate towards each other. There are also various interactions with their teachers and some bullying that's brought to the fore, and the film explores the different perspectives of the bullying from the teachers, the parents, the children, and how we see the different interpretations of events. And it's a film with a lot of heart to it. It's also quite devastating and poignant, but it's very beautifully filmed as well. And the child stars just perform really well.
That's great.
Well, good. Yeah, I hadn't heard of it before, but once again, that's what these kinds of shows let us do. They get us insight into the things that other people are paying attention to and that we haven't seen. I know, Howard, you mentioned, you know, that you only include things that you've seen. That's the way I work also. Nothing goes on the list unless I've seen it. So, but this is not one that I had even thought of seeing. So I've got it in my queue now.
Well, I certainly try to include some films that were not going to be the ones that have been nominated in all of the awards.
So. Oh, sure. Sure. Hey, the way I always do my list is I tell people straight up front, it's not necessarily the best films of the year. It's the ones that most resonated with me that I saw. They're the ones that I enjoyed, cared about, found something into love. Sometimes it matches up that they are the kinds of award-nominated films that you see showing up on everybody's best of list, but often they're outliers too. And I like the idea of these lists because everybody has a different way of doing it, and that's perfectly fine. That gets us a greater variety of films to talk about, and that's what I like about these kinds of programs. All right. Well, my number nine is the only comic book movie that I have on my list, and it's the only one that I saw this year that I gave a damn about. The others were not very good, and it's the third film in the series, The Guardians of the Galaxy, Volume 3. All right, so that's going to come up again later on. Well, we'll move to number 8. Rishabh, are you and I going to the movies again and going to disagree about something?
Well, I know, Richard, you were mentioning, you know, your list not always having the big Oscar contenders, but at number eight, I have one that's making waves at the awards, and that's The Little Indie That Could this year, the one that kind of took up a lot of the conversation for awards and just kind of has continued to roll out in terms of critical conversation, at least, and that is Past Lives.
Pineapple Kiosk.
All right.
That's on my honorable mention.
All right, so Past Lives will come up again later on. Howard, what have we got for next in the queue?
Society of Snow. This is the Spanish entry in the foreign film category of the Oscars. It, as I understand it, it's the same story as the movie Alive, based on a true story about a Uruguayan rugby team that crashes in the Andes. And then basically after a certain period, the world sort of gives up on trying to find them. On Facebook, I said, get out your handkerchiefs because by the time it's over, you're both crying, but you're also elated because basically it's about people who just don't give up no matter how bad things get.
And it, you know, I know that story has been made a couple of times. Have you seen any of the other films that, that were based on this incident? And how does this compare?
I haven't seen Alive. Someone on Facebook said this was better, but I haven't seen Alive myself.
I think Alive was a little bit later, and I think there was a like an instantaneous ripoff movie called Survive that came out like just a year or two after the event happened. Alive, I think, was a few years afterwards. Yeah, no, it's an interesting story. It's obviously going to be compelling for people to watch, but I haven't seen this yet. I think it's been mentioned on the show earlier in the year, and I'm trying to remember what the context was. But so it's at least the second mention of this movie on the show, and again, something that should encourage people to seek it out. Well, Tony, let's see if we can pineapple kiosk something else.
So my number eight is the first of three animated films I've got on my list, and it's one of the stream releases this year, which is Nimona.
I think you're good.
Okay, so this one, firstly, I just one I'm actually amazed that it's actually being released at all, because this was originally being made by Blue Sky Studios. But when Disney shut Blue Sky down in 2021, this film ends up getting scrapped, even after like a lot of the animation being done, a lot of the voice acting had been recorded, and yeah, there's like one of that it probably would never see the light of day. But Netflix and Dan the Perner Pictures, they picked it up and were able to get it released. So I'm just glad that we've got to see the light of day. And the film itself, I just found it really entertaining, great film. Like, part of it is due to two central performances we've got from Chloe Grace Moretz and Riz Ahmed. There's a really great rhythm that the two have with each other in their dialogue, like with Riz Ahmed's character being like this person who's being given the role of villain because he doesn't, at the start, because he didn't necessarily fit the specific ideals and perspective of what a traditional hero should be in their society, and then getting framed for murder because of how not fitting those ideals, and then Moretz's Nimona being this more being of chaos, like a shapeshifter to just change your identity around that will. And the dynamic that the two have together just creates a lot of great comedy and dramatic moments in the film. Yes, works really well in terms of showing a good LGBT plus representation in animation. I know that one of the concerns Disney had when it was being done by Blue Sky was they wanted to cut out a kiss between two of the characters because of a same-sex kiss. And you know, now the film we've got, that kiss is preserved. But even like just the character of Nimona being like, and creating questions of identity and like being I definitely see like how people who are like transgender, non-binary, would really relate to the character of Nimona. Actually, and then as the film goes on, we see some of the darker elements of it too. At the point where the end action scene is a suicide attempt, and so it gets some. But even though like, a lot of the darker moments, it still gets bounced out by a lot of great light-hearted action, some great comedy. I mean, even like there's an extended bit which is just an extended reference to Kick-Ass, which I doubt that a lot of the children that will be watching this on Netflix would really get. But yeah, it's just one that I just like watching, just fell in love with it. Even with like the animation, it's a bit more simplistic compared to other animated films we've had this year, but it's one where it works. Like the simplistic animation, the style, the colours works for the tone and the story that's being told, and gives it a kind of unique feeling, helps it stand out as compared to other animated films. And yeah, I just found it to be a really entertaining film.
Well, over the years, I've had a lot of animated films on my list that I've included because I really am a fan of animated movies. But the last couple of years, I haven't had any, and I'm glad that you've got three on your list this year. That feels like it's balancing me out a little bit. This is interesting. I'm not familiar with this movie at all. Has anybody else seen it?
I have, yes. Oh. And attended a screening as well where the animator and the directors were there. And so it was really interesting to hear about that journey that Tony has mentioned, where the film was actually curtailed for a while before Annapurna and Netflix came on board. And the animator as well was discussing how the story originally arose and the sketches they were doing, and it started online on a particular website as various chapters, and then it grew a fan base and then became the film. And so that was a really interesting process to hear about, and it's a very emotional film. There's a lot of layers to it, a lot of depth as well, so I enjoyed it when I watched it.
Good deal. Well, Latoya, you're back up. What's the next film that you wanted to talk about?
Right. So the next film that I have, probably will be Pineapple Kiosked, is All of Us Strangers.
I haven't been able to see it yet, but boy, I do.
Yeah, I was going to say. So go ahead.
Okay. This is the latest film by Andrew Haig, starring, has a really good cast to it. So you have Andrew Scott and Paul Mescal and Claire Foy in there. And I will just forewarn everyone, it is utterly devastating as a film. It does have a mystery surrounding it. It tells a tale of a writer who is reliving some of his childhood memories, returns to his family home, and then you're presented with scenarios that seem surreal but also provide him with that opportunity to speak of who he really is to members of his family, and have conversations that he wished he could have had. But also looks into certain historical politics, as there is an LGBTQ narrative as well, and has a love interest element too, but again, that's shrouded in mystery and is really quite intimate and a character study, but also really good editing in keeping the mystery until the end. And that is one I would definitely say to bring the tissues. I think everyone that's watched it has just been emotionally impacted whilst watching this film, and it's very good.
Well, I don't know if it's good news or bad news that the rest of us haven't been emotionally impacted because we haven't had a chance to see it yet, but I'm glad that you saw it and have recommended it. That's terrific. And I know that Howard has been mentioning wanting to see this. I think that came up last week, and you hadn't been able to see it yet either.
No, it has not opened in the theaters yet, I don't think.
Okay.
I mean, for qualification for the Oscars, but other than that, for Fuller Run, it hasn't opened.
All right. Well, we'll keep our eyes open, and maybe it'll show up, assuming that it gets some of those award attention things that they were looking for. My number eight, go ahead. I was going to say, my number eight film, I have two non-English language films on my list, that we're going to be talking about in the future.
Oh, no.
And, that's a change of pace for me. But this one is easy because the lead character, not only is the film not in English, the lead character doesn't even speak until the very last line of the film. And it's Sisu.
Yeah. Well, I'm going to say Pineapple Kiosk, but we might as well talk about it because that's my next choice.
Okay.
It's number seven for me. So I don't know if you want to talk now or wait till it gets to me.
No, we can do that. Talk now, and then we'll skip over you when we get to it next, after Rishabh talks about whatever he has as number seven. So Sisu is, what would you describe it as, Howard? Is it it's Finnish exploitation film?
It's a Finnish spaghetti western. I was trying to find out some
set in World War II.
Right. I was trying to find some food from Finland, so we could call it, you know, the something western, but I forgot what I, probably gefilte fish or something western in Finland, but it's basically a spaghetti western in World War II at the, in Finland, Lapland actually, but that's part of Finland.
Yeah. So in this film, retreating Nazis basically steal a collection of gold that has been found by a prospector who is a former fighter in the resistance movement against the Nazis, and they discover that just because they have a tank and a lot of men, that is not necessarily sufficient to hold on to the stolen gold and avoid being, well, let's just say, slaughtered in a variety of ways. This is definitely an exploitation film that takes advantage of freedom of violence on screen, because we get a lot of it. And there are some, of course, improbable sequences, but the improbable sequences don't undermine the visceral nature of the violence. It's pretty intense in those scenes that they have. And the lead actor, who I'd only seen once before in Rare Exports, and I think this film is also directed by the same director who made Rare Exports.
I think so.
Yes, it is.
He's terrific in this movie. And like I said, and he doesn't have any lines. And there's a dog. So it goes on my list for those reasons.
But it's a movie that you just can't stop watching. Doesn't matter if it makes any sense or logic or anything, you just can't stop watching it.
Well, I don't understand why anybody would want to stop watching it. It's very fulfilling for the kind of thing that you're looking for. If that's what you're looking for, if you're looking for a revenge film filled with graphic violence and a just cause where Nazis get what they deserve, this is it. Rishabh, how about number seven on your list?
All right, so for my number seven, I'm keeping my one comic book movie a year and animated film. It's Spider-Man Across the Spider-Verse.
Pineapple Kiosk.
All right.
All right, so that'll come up again. And Howard, we just heard your number seven. So, right. Tony, how about you? What's your number seven?
My number seven is Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 3.
All right, so you and I are the only ones who have this on our list. Good deal. Go ahead.
So, yeah, I think for me, the first Guardians of the Galaxy is my favorite film of the Marvel Cinematic Universe. It's one of the films that I've seen the most in cinemas. I saw the first one four times, so in the cinema. So, and I've just been really impressed with this franchise, this specific side of the MCU as it's been going on. But definitely more of the funner, lighter side for the, well, up until this one, which is one of the darkest films of the MCU. Not the darkest, but it's one where, like, the darkness feels earned because you've got to know and connect with these characters over the previous two films and then Infinity War and Endgame. And as you've, you know, getting that real connection bond with these with them, and just the way that they all interact with each other, it just feels really natural. You definitely see the years of chemistry that have been building up between everyone. And I mean, it's probably getting this scene compared to other films of his. I'd say this is one of Bradley Cooper's best performances as, when we're getting here, as Rocket. Well, not just as Rocket, but one of his best performances in just in general. And it's one where you definitely feel like the personality of James Gunn come through in throughout the film. Like a lot of other MCU films, they feel more generic. You don't get this set the individual stamp of the main creative team. It feels more producer led. But the Guardians films, they've always definitely felt like they're James Gunn's films first and MCU films second. And the way that Gunn's able to, you know, blend the, like, darker elements, especially for Rocket's backstory, and a really love-to-hate villain with, I hope I'm pronouncing his name right, Chukwudi Awuji as the High Evolutionary. He's just, well, it's to the point where when Rocket, when his face gets scratched off, you're just really happy that he's finally got some come up, at least some form of comeuppance for his actions, because he's a truly detestable villain. And even like the music as well has that darker feel. Like the previous films, the opening credit songs were Come and Get Your Love and Mr. Blue Sky, and here it's Radiohead's Creep. But and somewhere, even like as the songs go on and the music advances, the music adds to the story, especially the final news drop before the credits of The Dog Days Are Over, and kind of the shift away from the like more 80s, 70s, 80s, 90s music that we've been getting from the other soundtracks and Quill's mindset, and then as going to this The Dog Days Are Over, in the shift towards Rocket as the leader. And it's only, get just as that's a bit of emotional catharsis, this ending of the era for this run for the Guardians. It just felt right for them.
Yeah, I think that this was a satisfying conclusion to the long-term story of the Guardians, which is, you know, the three films plus their participation in the final Avengers films. I think that we get the most emotionally affecting sequence in any of the MCU films in this particular film, and you've already mentioned it, you know, the backstory about Rocket and the other genetically manipulated creatures in the laboratory there. I think that that does a lot to kind of pull us in emotionally and make us care about what's happening. The needle drops are a little bit different, and they're certainly different in tone, but I'll tell you one, the one I smiled the most at was, you know, the Beastie Boys one when they get to the hallway fight.
Well, definitely, you know, that's something in the Super Mario Bros. Movie.
Yes, I didn't see the Super Mario Brothers movie, which apparently is like the biggest movie of the year around the world, and I just skipped it because I wasn't thinking. I wasn't thinking. What am I doing? I'm on the outside with Barbie and Super Mario Brothers. Damn. But yeah, the Guardians of the Galaxy, and I also like the fact that they've kind of introduced additional characters into the story that, should they decide to come back to these people, it doesn't necessarily have to be that first group. And I think we would feel justified if they did come back. But I don't think it's necessary to come back. I think we are satisfied with the way this is wrapped up here. And I really enjoyed the film, like I said, of the comic book movies that came out this year. I thought it was the one that worked the best, had the most interesting stories, and I tell you what, in addition to the sadness about the critters, it's awfully disturbing to think there's a whole planet that vanishes as part of this movie, and we were on that planet with those people, and it's not just Alderaan blowing up and we were never there. This is like, we were just there. This was what was going on, and it's all gone.
And it's not, not just and, that the planet gets destroyed, it's just how matter of fact the evolutionary is.
Yes, it's
just
exactly.
Like, oh, well, tell us what I mean, blow it up. And that makes it more disturbing, just how casually does it mean things, how many other planets has he destroyed?
Yeah, it's not a good thought. Well, Latoya, what's your good thought for your next seventh spot?
So my next film is a Canadian one, and it's called Brother by Clement Virgo. Okay, no one has that on their list yet.
Okay, you're good, yeah.
this is a tale of two brothers, and charts a time in their life in the 90s, and so there is a lot of reference to the 90s fashion and music there. The soundtrack is superb, ranging from jazz music to hip-hop and R&B and quite a few Nina Simone needle drops in there as well, which also convey the emotion and the journey that these two brothers have living with their mother as Caribbean migrants, and how they are then having to navigate external forces that are maybe trying to quash their potential. And so it looks at their relationship, family relationship, relationship with friends, and also how their ambition and life choices are impacted as well. And you have some really quite powerful performances in there as well. And again, like I said, a fantastic soundtrack.
Well, thank you, Latoya, bringing another one to our attention. My number seven is Sound of Freedom, which is the film that got shelved for a couple of years, got bought back by the company that produced it, got released in a very original way, and it is a horrifying story of the world today, and it's scary as hell. And if you are a parent and you're watching the first 15 minutes of this movie, you're going to have nightmares for a long time. It is traumatic, and it's really terrible to think about how this sort of thing goes on in the world. It's about human trafficking, in particular human trafficking about children. It features a character that's based on a real-life person who engaged in trying to rescue children who have been trafficked. And it's soul-crushing to think about what people have to do to track these sorts of things down and find the people that are responsible for it. And there are interesting performances in the film. It became kind of a sensation because it was controversial. There was stuff about it being QAnon film, and I think that's mostly kind of a ridiculous response from people who are not really seeing the film. And I thought the film was incredibly tense. Now, the whole last section where the rescue of the one girl takes place is mostly invented, but I think it's very well developed, and it fits in with the rest of the story. Jim Caviezel is the star of the film. I didn't recognize him for the first half of the movie. I didn't realize that his hair was lightened up, and I've seen him in other things, and it wasn't clicking to me that he was in the film until halfway through the film. And I know that he's also a controversial figure, so that probably turned a few people off. But like I said, this had an interesting marketing approach, and that was one of the things that I thought was worth recommending at the end of the movie as well, because they basically encouraged people to buy tickets for others. If you like the movie, buy tickets for other people, and they gave you a link to do that. And you could make it available to other people so that they would be able to see the movie without having to pay for it. And I thought that was kind of a strange approach for a film, but it appears to have been quite successful and it turned them into one of the top 10 hits of the year, surprisingly. I don't think anybody expected that for a film that was basically shelved for 2 or 3 years. All right, Rishabh, we're number 6.
Okay, perfect. So my number 6 is a little indie that I don't think got too much attention this year. The movie is called Shortcomings.
Shortcomings?
Shortcomings.
Oh, Shortcomings, okay.
Yep. And surprisingly, believe it or not, this is the feature directorial debut of Randall Park, of all people. When I first heard that, I was, you know, I mean, I'm sure he, I mean, I think he's a great performer. I just didn't know if he would really be able to direct a movie. But I was so surprised at how much I enjoyed this movie. First of all, it is based on a graphic novel. So I should mention this is actually also my other comic book movie of the year. It's an adaptation of a graphic novel by Adrian Tomine. Of course, it's a more of a dramatic or comedic graphic novel, not a superhero one at least. And this movie basically follows the story of a struggling Bay Area filmmaker named Ben Tanaka. And he's sort of this kind of a cynical and I guess in some ways kind of a critical, blunt kind of person. He's got a certain sensibility around him, which I think was really well captured here. And it's quite in my opinion, it's quite a refreshing take for Asian American representation. You have somebody who's not really checking the typical Hollywood boxes. It's somebody who's kind of flawed and almost uncomfortably realistic in some ways. He's very much a cynical person, and they show him to be that way almost throughout the film. And he has, as this title suggests, some major shortcomings, right? And it's a really good 90-minute dramedy that has a lot of sarcastic humor and kind of has a pointed approach towards some cultural things. And it's mostly about his, I guess, romantic life and a personal life, but you kind of get a really good sense of this character and a lot of the friends around him. There's also a really good supporting cast here featuring Sherry Cola and Ali Mackey, who have really good pivotal, hilarious roles. And interestingly, the movie starts with a really good parody of, you know, the iconic, kind of iconic opening scene of Crazy Rich Asians. And it's a parody that's in really good taste, I feel, and makes a really good point in terms of representation that we see in Hollywood. And I think the approach that Randall Park takes in parodying a movie that's, you know, so frequently celebrated and making a really good critical point about it was a really great opening scene for this film and kind of sets the tone for the rest of the movie. So I highly recommend checking out Shortcomings. It was definitely the biggest, I would say the biggest, one of the biggest surprises of the year for me.
Anybody else catch this one?
Yeah,
well,
I did.
There's something that...
I did.
You did?
I did.
Okay.
Yes. Yes. Yes, I thought it was quite... I thought it was quite fun, and it was interesting seeing the protagonist's journey as well, and how he changes from being quite controlling and then having to learn how to find his own identity and what he's interested in as well. So that was quite good. It almost seems like it's quite connected in ways to past lives, looking at that type of dynamic and representation and the difference between the various worlds and interactions that they have.
All right. Nice. Howard, you're up.
Well, my next one is an Italian film called The Eight Mountains. It's an incredibly beautiful film, both the story and the cinematography. It takes place in the Italian Alps, and it traces some friendship of two men starting when they're young teens over 4 decades. One eventually becomes a writer. The other keeps trying to make a go of living in this mountainous area, and I just thought it was an incredibly beautiful and very touching movie.
Has anybody else been able to see this?
Yes, I have.
Thank you, Latoya, for being on the show today, because you've managed to fill in some blank spaces whenever I need somebody to talk about another movie. This is great. So what did you think of Eight Mountains?
I loved it. It is visually stunning. It's again one of those tales that just talks to you about a really poignant moment in time where fate just decides somebody's ultimate destiny, you know, whether one of you can climb up the mountains or you can't, whether one of you goes with a relative and one stays. And it's just very, very moving and just really beautifully filmed, as mentioned.
Howard, did you see this in a theater, or was this something that you ended up having to stream?
Yes, I saw it on Criterion Channel. They sometimes have world premieres on Criterion.
All right, I'm going to look for it there. Tony, what have you got next?
See, am I next? Number six. I'm not sure if this will get a pineapple kiosk. Number six is Killers of the Flower Moon.
I think you're in.
So... yeah, I mean, definitely, like, with the streaming era for, like, Scorsese's films, it's definitely felt like streamers have been more willing to, allow them to indulge more, especially with runtimes, getting, the 3.5 hours of The Irishman now, the 3.5 hours of Killers of the Flower Moon. Although, it's somewhere, the way Scorsese paces his films, it's, they never feel like their length. I watched Killers of the Flower Moon in the cinema, in IMAX, and as the film went on, it's one I just never noticed how long it was. There's even ones where there's films I've been a lot shorter that have felt a lot longer. But the way that Scorsese works here, especially with presenting this story, it's definitely tell where it started. Intending it to be more of the police procedural type film focused on the investigation, but by changing the focus and making it more about the murders themselves and focusing on the reactions of the Osage community and those people, it gives it more of a interesting angle, especially with how it presents the characters played by Leonardo DiCaprio and Robert De Niro, with different aspects of evil in them, the more, for lack of a better term, dumb evil that DiCaprio brings to the role, and really chilling evil from De Niro. For a lot of the film, first of all, really sickened watching it, and just how banal everyone was, all the white population was acting towards the Osage, how they feel like it was their natural right to kill them, Hale and his conspirators just dehumanized the Osage community, they're not done really counts as people, so they just felt completely justified in murdering them, and it just felt really sickening. But also, there's an interesting look at the way the traditions of the Osage were being diluted by wealth and exposure to the more, I don't know if that's the right way to describe it, but the more white aspects of America, and having them seeing the cultural traditions of the Osage get diluted as they get more as wealth, and then showing how they can really need to be revived and brought back to help show the community as their strength, especially when we get to the ending and we see how the story has predominantly been described in the media, the use of the radio play at the end, I found was a stroke of genius from Scorsese to show how a lot of the traditional history and perception of those crimes lionized the FBI in its early days and the federal investigators, whilst kind of denying the agency of the Osage, and definitely ending it with the modern Osage powwow works really well in showing how the efforts of Hale and his conspirators and how the screen has been seeing things dilute those traditions are still alive and well today. So obviously we've got, you know, great ensemble cast. We mentioned DiCaprio and De Niro, great knits. Obvious standout is Lily Gladstone, who's this more quiet, reserved presence, but you can see how it feels more like a defense mechanism in some ways as a reaction to how the Osage have been treated in the past and how it, and just how isolated, even when an area that should be her home, how she feels like an outsider, especially with the way that Scorsese and ZPZ has all framed the Osage in comparison with the white, with the white population, and just found it to be really dark, disturbing, and really engaging film from Scorsese.
Well, Howard was on the show with me when we did this as an original film on the Lambcast back in October when it first debuted, and I think we both liked the movie quite well. Howard was especially frustrated by the fact that the focus was on DiCaprio's character as opposed to Lily Gladstone's character. Isn't that right, Howard? Am I summarizing your view correctly?
Sort of. You're exaggerating a bit how much you liked it. I think it is a wonderful Act 1 and a wonderful Act 3, but that Act 2 is really a drag and difficult to get through, mainly because it is focused on the wrong character, so everything gets thrown off structurally. And Leonardo DiCaprio, who was miscast, plays a very boring character, and he plays it very boringly. I also didn't like the radio show at the end, because all I'm thinking is, this doesn't remotely resemble how a radio show is done. Scorsese pulls out all these bells and whistles, and that's just not how radio shows work. But I liked Act 1, Act 2, but Act 1, Act 3, but Act 2 was a real drag to get through.
Well, I'm surprised that it's not on anybody else's list. Nobody else seems to have included it. There are a couple of these films that I think did get quite a bit of critical acclaim that appear to be isolated in people's choices. Probably we're looking for diversity here with this group as opposed to consensus, which is perfectly fine. Latoya, what diversity box are we going to check with your next film as opposed to what consensus film?
Right. I suspect that my next film may be on others' lists as it's Past Lives.
Pineapple Kiosk.
All right, there you go. So we'll be coming back to that one. My number six film is one that did get mentioned on last week's show, and I really enjoyed it. I thought it was interestingly done. It has a couple of terrific performances, and it's Maestro from Bradley Cooper. I like the subject matter very much. I think Leonard Bernstein's a very interesting character. His persona is presented here as much as he was maybe a political figure and somewhat of an activist. That doesn't seem to be the focus of the movie. It's the focus of the movie is on his personality and the way it affected his relationships with others, in particular his wife. And I thought that dynamic in the film was very nicely played, both in the opening sections, which are done in one format, and in the later sections, the last two-thirds of the film, which seems to be done in a completely different format. And I think that Cooper makes a couple of choices about the aspect ratio in the film, about the use of color or black and white that add to the feel of the film being closer to being like an insight into seeing these people. It's almost like a documentary that's been assembled from found footage, but it's not, because it doesn't really just go through the high points of his career. It's not one of those ones that checks off every little element of his biography and gives us something to comment on. It felt to me very different. I know Howard was not as enthusiastic about it. His description of it was, it's the best kind of film for somebody who's fishing for an Oscar nomination.
When it comes to the purpose of the film, I can't remember word for word what you said. For me, the only purpose of the film is to give Bradley Cooper an Oscar, which he's not going to get. I thought Carey Mulligan stole the movie. I think she's great. But I think all the directorial flourishes are unimaginative, or I've seen them done a million times. So I wasn't as impressed. Bradley Cooper is fine. It's a perfectly okay movie, but that's all it was for me.
Well, I'm more enthusiastic, so there you go.
There you go.
Rishabh, we're back to you.
All right, so for my number five, this was a movie I was looking forward to, mostly because this is a franchise or a series, you could say, that I've kind of grown up with. It was pretty, I guess, formative for me when I was a teenager. I think for a lot of people my age, this was a series that they kind of grew up with and maybe have a lot of good memories associated with. It's also part of a subgenre or a type of movie that we don't get to see a lot of anymore, which is basically like a young adult dystopian kind of subgenre that we've kind of lost over time. So for me, number five is the new Hunger Games movie, The Ballad of Songbirds and Snakes. And I'm assuming no one else has this. So I'll just say, I think there was a lot of hope and fear around this movie in terms of it being a big prequel to a well-known series that had probably kind of faded from people's memory at this point. But I was kind of, I went into this nervous, expecting it to, you know, maybe not live up to what the original series was. And to an extent, I would still agree it doesn't live up to the best of the series, or at least the best one or two movies of the series. But I thought this was a rare prequel that mostly lived up to the legacy of the original franchise and then enhanced it or accentuated it in unique ways. I think that the story, which takes the approach of an origin story for Carolina Snow, who's kind of President Snow in the original franchise, having that as the main character study, going back into the history of Pan Am and exploring some of the unique political scenarios that were happening in the past of this series was kind of an interesting way of looking at it. And I actually quite enjoyed the way that they also focus on this relationship between Snow and this unexpected mentee he has in the Hunger Games named Lucy Gray, who I think was essayed by Rachel Zegler in what has been her most notable performance in her career so far, in my opinion at least. And I liked the structure of the movie. I know it packed in a lot of action, charm, and the way it goes from has sort of like a two-half structure to it, where we have a first half where, you know, you see the Hunger Games aspect of it, and the second aspect where you see a little bit more of a character study for Snow himself. There's sort of a melodramatic soul to the movie, which I kind of actually enjoyed. It reminded me of the original series and a lot of things that I liked about it. And the original director has also, or the director for Catching Fire and the three subsequent movies, kind of returned to direct this one. And I found there to be a good amount of nuance in here as well. And I found it to be one of my kind of favorite kind of blockbuster mainstream movies of the year. I thought I really enjoyed this one.
Well, I think I lost interest in the Hunger Games movies after the second movie in the series. I saw the third one. I went, that was such a decline in quality and interest. And the third one got cut into two parts, didn't it? I'm trying to remember. That seemed to be like a standard thing, correct, that they did. And I'm not even sure if I saw the second part of the third one. So,
That's the one where you didn't miss my trick.
Okay, good.
And if there was any films in this series that should be, that probably would benefit from being done in series, it's Ballad of Songbirds and Snakes. Actually, the third, that felt really rushed to me, and I think it may have benefited from being done as two films.
Oh, interesting. Okay.
Well, they'll be sorry about that when they check their pocketbook at the end of the year. Dang. Howard, what's your number five film?
Godzilla Minus One.
So I know. Does anybody have Godzilla Minus One higher on their list? No. So we're going to talk about it now. And so I think three of us have it on our list. So, Howard, since you tripped the fantastic here, let's have you first.
Well, When I watched the old Godzilla and Japanese monster films, I don't watch them because they're good. I watch them because they're cheesy and bad. So I really wasn't looking forward to this, especially after the terrible American versions that have come out lately. But on Facebook, people kept saying, you've got to see this, you've got to see this. And I go see it, and it's just amazing. It's a character-driven monster movie in which I think the people appear more than the monster. On Facebook, I said that all the critical acclaim was going to Maestro, Killers of the Flower Moon, and Barbie, and I thought this one was better than all three of them put together.
Yeah, and we talked about it a little bit last week. I wouldn't say that it was better than all three of those other movies put together, but it was number 10 on my list. I thought it was an excellent Godzilla movie, and the reason that it works is because they focus on the characters and the story first instead of trying to make the movie all about the mayhem of Godzilla. Tony, you also had this on your list at number 10, right?
Yeah, I did. I also found that you work with giving all the focus on the characters and actually giving the characters the time to develop, especially with the American MonsterVerse films. There's definitely those ones, the human characters are really underdeveloped, so that for me, a lot of points, I didn't really care about them, and I'm only mainly watched them for the big over the top action scenes. With this one, it feels it has that much more darker take, more going back to the original 1954 Godzilla. More tragic element, this force of nature that's absolutely horrifying to experience on the ground, and especially with the way it shows the different cultural attitudes towards the Japanese military and the survivors of World War II and the US bombings, and let me see it as this kind of extension of war trauma in this instance, rather than the threat of nuclear war and nuclear holocaust that we've seen in for this the tone and the story that's being told here.
Now, to me, it was the setting was very interesting, and I think it was Todd who. Somebody mentioned it last week when we were talking about it. They thought it was a little bit of that kind of redemptive story, I think it was Todd who said that they compared it a bit to Rambo Part 2, where this time we get to win. And, the Japanese military, which had just recently been defeated in World War II, gets a chance to redeem itself a little bit by successfully thwarting Godzilla, although of course success is a relative term whenever you're talking about a franchise that has more than 30 entries in it, and I suspect we'll have additional ones.
And also, there was no Japanese military at the time, so
Basically been decimated. Yeah.
No, it's the U.S. that you were not having a military. Your military is done.
Disbanded.
Yeah.
And just as a side note, because it is minor interest, it's set immediately after the war. My father was part of the occupying forces in Japan, and a lot of the scenes that they show where Japan's going through recovery, I've got a few photographs here and there where you can see some of that kind of stuff in the background. And it's an interesting time period, so... there's a reason that it's set in that time period. I think that it works pretty well, and it's kind of silly that the way they managed to exclude the U.S. military from the whole process, but like we said, the idea here is that there's a resilience and the ability to respond to this emergency that comes up here, and I kind of like the idea that they're winging it as their own little military group. Like Howard said, it's not an official military response. Everything has been jimmied together. So it's an interesting idea. Tony, what's your number five film?
So my number five is the second of the animated films I've got on my list, and it's Spider-Man Across the Spider-Verse.
I have a kiosk, but that's my next one, so... When it comes to me, we can talk about it now.
It's my number five as well.
Yeah, well, let's go ahead and talk about it now, since it was going to come up for Latoya next as well. So, Tony, you hit the right spot. You're up first.
Yeah, so, I mean, for me, like, this is, like, run of Spider-Man films from, like, the animation ones. I find these to be a lot better than the more recent live-action ones that the MCU have been doing. And a lot of it is partly the idea of the focus on Miles Morales doing it, his story, rather than Peter Parker. Like, we've seen the Peter Parker story done like two other times before the MCU, and in films, and not counting all the TV shows and cartoons with the character. And so going on, focus on Miles Morales helps give it just a different feel to it compared to the other Spider-Man films we've got. And it's even where here there's a lot of the meta commentary you get. You know, all the people who are saying, "Oh, Miles Morales isn't Spider-Man." You see all the angry YouTubers, all the, you know, that kind of people say, just giving those comments, and a lot of that is given direct text here to say, and just refuting all those people and saying, "No, Miles Morales is Spider-Man, and it's wrong to say otherwise." And just one way, it has a bit of a darker feel to it. You'll definitely be the second part of the trilogy, The Empire Strikes Back, of this run of Spider-Man films. But it's one I find really works, having this bit of a darker feel towards the end. And the voice acting from everyone involved is great. Well, I have to give a special shout out to the scenes between Hayley Steinfeld and Shea Whigham. Sort of the great emotional beats of the film come from the scenes that those two have together. And it sort of works in how it develops Gwen Stacy's character and showing someone, you know, the coming to terms with the loss and how the family relationship, the damage that being Spider-Man can do to someone's life. And, you know, that's really beautiful moments, especially at the end of the film, like the last big conversation that those two have, combined with the animation, is just really beautiful moments in the film. And just, you know, which the animation itself is just still stunning. The changing frame rates works out to give each character a unique feel, especially with Spider-Punk here. It feels like characters that just come straight from a Sex Pistols album cover. And you know, works really well combined with Daniel Kaluuya's voice performance. You know, it just works really well to, you know, create this really, you know, tight, engaging film. And I'm really excited to see like the closure of the series, hoping that the animators get better treatment next time round. So,
well, this was a film that, you know, probably would trade places on my list with Godzilla Minus One if I had seen it a second time, because I remember liking it quite well. I do think it had the one issue, and you mentioned it, it's kind of like Empire Strikes Back. It leaves you hanging because it is a cliffhanger conclusion to the film, and it's not coming next year, so it's a couple years away that we're going to get that. We were promised it next year, but of course it all got delayed because of events in the world. And including, you know, those things that affect the writers and the animators. So I'm looking forward to the second part, and maybe when I see it as a whole, it would, you know, maybe I can revisit this year and change my list again. I thought it was a spectacular looking movie. I just, like I said, didn't have quite the same impact without having seen it a second time. So I have no criticisms of it, except for that somebody squawked about it last week that they didn't like the fact that the films ended on a cliffhanger. And I'm trying to remember, I think it was Thomas who was unhappy that Dune, you know, finished and we had to come back 3 years later, 2 years later for part two. I'm going, that's not atypical, and I'm not sure why that's a problem. It just gives me something to anticipate.
So Spider-Man, I was also really impressed by the animation, the quality of the animation and the characters. And I liked the emphasis within this film on Spider-Man being part of a team throughout the multiverse, and also we were given that opportunity to have more insight into the other spider people as well. So I thought that was really good. I liked how there was also that emphasis again on the consequences of his decisions and how it impacted his family and friends as well with Miles. And I thought that the perspective is really good as well, also showing the difficulties in school that he has too, and trying to be a superhero and try to fulfill all of his other roles and obligations as well. And I did like that it ended on a cliffhanger, because it then gives you that sensation of wanting to know what happens next, rewatching it several times over, looking for other clues. The steampunk character was great, that whole eccentric Britishness there, and someone who's just like, yes, I don't really care, I'm anti-establishment, so I'm going to bend the rules and help you, even though all of the others, because you haven't quite fulfilled what may be your destiny or not as this ultimate one, I'm still going to help you. And so I liked all of those dynamics in it too.
Yeah, right before that, I just wanted to add, because Spider-Man was also my number 7. I think I had the lowest of everyone, but I just wanted to echo what everyone else has said too, and say that what I really liked about this one is just the emotional honesty of it. And I think both the movies are super poignant. And I think everybody has basically mentioned all the main things about it. I mean, the visuals, the resonant moments, the meta-aware education. I think that's what has consistently brought the Spider-Verse franchise into the limelight. So just wanted to add that, since I had it at 7.
Well, speaking of anticipation, I had the exact opposite of that for my number 5 film. It was a film that I didn't anticipate, I didn't think we needed, I didn't have high expectations for it at all. I went to it primarily because other people online started suggesting that maybe I was wrong about my prejudices about it, and everybody else was correct, and I was wrong. Wonka is completely charming and ended up in the number 5 spot on my list, a film that I expected to have disdain for, and it worked in ways that I was really surprised at. They do have a lot of touches that connect to the original Gene Wilder version of the film that I thought were subtle but honest and fair, and didn't seem exploitive of the film. I think the production design is terrific, and it's a musical, and I was surprised at how much I enjoyed the musical sequences. They were great, probably better than some of the musical sequences in the original, like I said, the production is very different, and it's a spectacular looking film. It's made by the director who did Paddington and Paddington 2, two films that I absolutely adore, so that was something that made me a little bit more hopeful about it. And when I saw the film, I just said, thank goodness that I was wrong, and that this turned out to be something worthwhile. So I'm very enthusiastic about Wonka.
Yeah, you definitely see like Warner Brothers, that it could have been this really cynical like cash grab trying to retain the rights for this character, since like Netflix were getting other Roald Dahl adaptations. But you know, Paul King and Simon Farnaby writing the script and Paul King directing it, he's got the rights eye for it to just make it a really charming film. Like Timothy Chalamet's really like charming lead as Wonka. You've got great hammy villains from Olivia Colman, Tom Davis, Patterson Joseph, Matt Lucas, Matthew Bainton. Just a great set of like top British acting and comedic talent in the smaller roles. And even the sort of like in like little bits in the songs, like as a fan of like Taskmaster and Ghost, just seeing a song number and then seeing Phil Wang and Charlotte Ritchie turn up is just a little bit of a delight. And yeah, it's just a really just charming film. And it's also great to see how well it's been doing in the UK. Like, I've been seeing it twice now in the cinema. And the second time, it was on, you know, it was saying when pretty much every screening of Wonka that day was sold out. And even like up until like even this weekend, I've been going to cinema. I've still been seeing loads of people going to see Wonka several weeks after release. It's probably going to be number one, maybe number one in the box office again in the UK this weekend. Just great to see that.
Yeah, it's nice that this quality is paying off with some success. Now you're number four, Rishabh.
Yes. So at number four, I have the one, I think, major directorial debut that I have on this top 10 list, which was by Chloe DeMont this year. This movie took me definitely quite a bit by surprise. The movie is Fair Play. So I think this movie really was quite surprising for me. The two leads are Phoebe Denevor, hopefully I got that last name right, and Alden Ehrenreich, both of whom I think gave two of the best performances of the year, two of the most effective performances of the year as well. And it's really kind of in some ways a big deconstruction or a different lens to a lot of movies that we would see in the 90s. I mean, think Basic Instinct, Indecent Proposal, in terms of it being about psychology and attraction, but in a very different lens and a slightly more cynical, even disturbing lens at one point. So you get to see basically the story of two people who are working in an investment bank. It's a kind of a very fast-paced, competitive environment. They're two colleagues who are kind of at the same level at the beginning of the film and are also secretly in a romantic relationship with one another. But things get challenging and quite different when basically Phoebe Denevor's character gets promoted and starts managing Alden Ehrenreich's character. And it's very much a story about jealousy, obviously, from the point of view from Alden Ehrenreich, who's kind of deep-seated insecurities and jealousies start coming up to surface, and we see that maybe he's not this amazing, and that basically both of them aren't this amazing couple that they seem to be, right? I mean, it's a secret romance, and now with this new power structure change, things start getting more and more challenging. And what I found to be quite intelligent about this movie is that, you know, this could have taken the typical kind of approach of just focusing on Alden's character and his jealousy and mostly showcasing his point of view. But what was nice was that we got to see more of Phoebe Denevor's character's point of view. And I would say that her character ends up being the most well explored. And it's not just about Alden's character being kind of always jealous, but it's also about how it impacts Phoebe Denevor's character and how this relationship overall starts getting more and more fraught, to say the least. And it's a really good take on a lot of themes that I think are quite, you know, timely and important to discuss right now in terms of power and, again, gender roles. I think of all the movies that I saw this year, I thought this was the most pointed and effective, important take on gender roles. I mean, you think Poor Things, Barbie, all those movies, I think, you know, they're good in their own right, but I felt that Fair Play was a very strong movie on that theme, and this is a very solid debut for a first-time director. It has a lot of conviction to it.
Well, I'm going to assume Latoya has seen this movie.
Yes, I have.
What did you think?
Yes, I did like it as well. I liked the way that it deconstructed a lot of the workplace politics as well. So I thought that was really well done, and just having that insight into the dynamics between their relationship behind closed doors as well, after having the girlfriend become the boss, was also quite fascinating to see how their relationship disintegrated from being quite loving and supportive to becoming quite toxic, and actually then started reflecting some of the toxic workplace dynamics as well. So that was all really quite interesting. So it's darkly humorous, very well made and well acted as well.
Anybody else got 2 cents that they want to throw into this? All right, then we're going to move on. Howard, you're up next.
Well, is this the fourth?
Yes.
Well, that was Spider-Man Across the Spider-Verse.
Oh,
That was my fourth.
Okay, that's right. That's why Spider-Man was so damn popular.
Yes.
On our show today, which is great. Okay, so Tony, what have you got at number four?
So my number four is the final animated film I've got on my list, and that's the new Hayao Miyazaki film, The Boy and the Heron.
All right.
So, yeah, I mean, this was one that I saw at the 2023 London Film Festival, and one that, you know, it's the main one that I want to see there, and also one that I've seen both the original, like, the Japanese and the English dub of it. And it's kind of interesting seeing, like, some of the difference between the, like, different, like, audio tracks for it. Like, it's not a lot of them. It, partly the reason I wanted to watch the English sub was to hear Robert Pattinson's voice acting as the Heron. Because, like, the story film and, like, it's like, Pattinson's performance is completely out there, bonkers, and it's really weird performance that is works to the character, and like, very similar to the original Japanese one. And I also find it interesting that originally, when they were thinking of doing the dub, they originally thought of Danny DeVito for the but then Jimmy got them to cast the younger one and got Robert Pattinson involved. Anyway, move on from that. Somehow I find it like definitely feels like a more autobiographical film from Miyazaki, like the main character growing up at the same time in the countryside of Japan during World War II, after this character's woman was killed during, was working in the hospital, which was destroyed during bombing raids by the Americans. And a lot of the film is focused on his grief of that loss and having to come to terms with it, with the loss and having a new family, with his dad marrying his mum's sister and having a new sibling from that, and this good chunk of film is to having a interactions between the main character and the younger version of his mum, which creates a really interesting dynamic. Works for exploring that grief and sense of loss and the idea of whether, you know, changing the, want to change history and the future, even if you know the more horrific ways that and actions that would happen in it, and also how the, you know, the darkness and of that grief and pain can help cause serious psychological damage to someone, and how it can kind of infecting and destroying his ability to create more meaningful emotional connections with people, and makes it really dark, depressed story in a lot of parts. But it's also one that has this lots of lightness and comedy. Like, a lot of good comedy bits in the film come from a society of parakeets that have been evolved in the fantasy world of the film, and it's part of his, especially in the English film, seeing the big imposing king of the parakeets voiced by Dave Bautista. It's just a great bit of like casting as a bit of the contrast between the character design and, you know, we never kind of accept in any other circumstances to see Dave Bautista voicing a parakeet. But even then, like, it's what. Well, even if the more comedic characters and ideas of film, there's an underlying darkness to it all that makes it really like engaging watch, and also really just ideas that play about memory and, you know, having to retain memories of traumatic events and more fantastical elements of the world. That gives it a bit more of an edge. And I think that has to be expected from a 2D Ghibli film. The animation is absolutely stunning, especially like there's some parts earlier on with showing the bombings that create more sketchy style to it that gives it a bit unique feel compared to other Ghibli films. And especially when compared to something like Earwig and the Witch, it really shows that Ghibli's animation style just shouldn't be 3D, it has to be 2D animation. And yeah, it's just great to see we're getting more Studio Ghibli, and we may be getting more Miyazaki films. Don't know what happens. Not happy with that, but yeah, it's just really great film and reminds of just how good the work of Studio Ghibli is.
Does anybody else have some insights on The Boy and the Heron?
It's on my honorable mention list. It's incredibly beautiful to look at, and the story works. If I have an issue with it, I have the same issue with all of these films. It often seems made up as it goes along. The story often doesn't have a very strong logic to it, but it's very enjoyable. And like I said, it's on my honorable mention list.
I was just going to reiterate as well that yes, it's beautifully drawn in terms of animation. I think with the plot line, I did find it slightly confused. Did seem to be a film of two halves, definitely, and some of the themes didn't always mesh together so well, but overall it's stunning to look at.
We have recommendations from everybody who's seen The Boy and the Heron, and one very enthusiastic scoring of it by Tony. Latoya, you're up next. What's your number four? What's the fourth film, or the number four film in this slot? I know that you didn't necessarily rank them.
Yes. So my next one is American Fiction.
Want to see it? Haven't been able to see it yet. Want to?
Yeah, looking forward to seeing it too.
Yes, that one is very impressive as a debut as well, and it's good to see Jeffrey Wright as well in a main actor role too. And it tells the tale of a writer. We seem to have quite a few films this year about writers. This is another one, and this writer's looking at popular fiction written by Black writers and how they may not necessarily be of a similar nature to his work, which he has written quite seriously and trying to reach an academic audience perhaps, and there are works that are slightly more populist but seem to resonate with people, and so he tries to play the game and see how that works, and there are surprising results. It doesn't quite go the way that he thinks it will. It doesn't quite go the way that we think it will as an audience either. And the film looks at a lot of elements such as conscious biases, the publication world and marketing, and people's perceptions of different types of representations and ethnic backgrounds, but also it has family relationships at its heart as well. So looking at acceptance within the family and the family dynamics and your place within a family, either as a sibling group, whether you're the eldest, the youngest, and your responsibilities as well. And so it's quite rich. There are some excellent one-liners in the film, and the dynamic between Jeffrey Wright and Tracy Ellis Ross is really good, and Erica Alexander is fantastic, and it's just really amusing, and also draws a lot of parallels to our own thoughts and processes, and I think it's definitely one that is worth watching.
Has anybody else seen it, or is it just on everybody else's want-to-see list?
It's not announced in the UK yet, so I've not been able to see it.
Yeah, it's starting to expand now in the US.
It's not playing at a theater near me.
So we'll all have comments about it when it gets around to us, but it sounds like Latoya's enthusiastic about it. I think somebody mentioned it last week on the show, and they went the opposite direction. So it's an interesting contrast that we've got going here. My number four film is a film that came out for a very short period of time. It was actually, I think, a Netflix film, and they decided to put it in theaters for a week, which makes it eligible for me to look at, because I don't evaluate films that I see online only. I only evaluate films I see in theaters. So I appreciate it, like Maestro got into the theaters for a week, and that was my opportunity to see it there. This falls in the same category, Air, with Matt Damon and Ben Affleck and Jason Bateman. It's a movie about a shoe, but it's a shoe that changed an industry. It was a big part of marketing Michael Jordan as a sports hero, and it is an interesting film that shows how these kinds of personas, products, and media come together to create a phenomena, and the phenomena of the Air Jordan shoe is one that is continuing today. It's unimaginable to me how much money they make off of these shoes, and Michael Jordan is still making more money off of the shoes now than he was making when he was playing basketball. It's just ridiculous, but it's a compelling story. It's well told. The actors are terrific. I think Matt Damon especially is very good in this role, and I'm sorry that he does not get as much mention here at the end of the year with all the other awards nominations coming around and attention being given to people's performances. I haven't heard him referred to, I think, at all, and I thought he was terrific in this particular film. Nobody else has seen it, or what's comment on it?
I have.
I knew you had. Because you've seen everything this week. That's great.
I think for me, I wish that there had been a bit more focus on Michael Jordan in the film. It seems to focus on the executives at Nike a bit more than him. And so...
Oh, a lot more than him. Yeah, yes, for sure.
Yeah.
He appears in the film as a character very late in the film for only a brief part of the film. And like I said, this is a movie more about the shoe than it is about the personality. But it's also about how that personality gets, you know, sold and connected with this product. I don't know what it says about consumerism, but it does say something. Fair enough. Rishabh, your number three film.
All right, my number three film is probably the movie that's, you know, either going to win me over a legion of fans or maybe make me hated by a legion of fans in the Lambcast. Because is this even a movie? I'm not sure. I did see it in the theater, and I saw it a few times, actually, which surprised me as well. And that is, drumroll please, Taylor Swift, The Eras Tour. Now, before we get into anything else, right? I think alive on Earth right now, you probably already know who she is. But I was a pretty casual fan before going in to see the movie, and I was quite skeptical about going to see it. I kind of just bought my ticket to kind of be part of this movement that was going to probably end up happening and just be a part of what was probably going to be an interesting time at the movies. Right before I went to go see it, I was almost willing to almost refund my ticket and just say, okay, I'm just going to skip this. I'm not sure if I'm, you know, built to handle this kind of a concert movie for 3 hours, only to find that the movie was completely non-refundable, which is an interesting policy that AMC has been putting out in the U.S. for concert movies. But I was totally enamored by what I saw in this movie, or this concert, I should say, and I was... turned from casual fan to still mostly a casual fan, but a big admirer of what she's doing as a musician and as an artist. I find it to be an incredibly inspiring display of artistry and music. This is someone who's clearly doing something they love, and that's coming and radiating off the screen completely. And I'm sure the live performance is even more interesting and more engaging, but I felt that what director Sam Wrench did in terms of capturing this 3-hour mega show and putting it on the big screen was quite incredible. I did see it the first time in IMAX, which I thought was really the most immersive and compelling way to see it. So, I mean, this is obviously a recommendation that some people will take more lightly or than others, but I would suggest checking it out once, or at least seeing if you're interested in it. I think this is something, especially if you're a fan of music or just artistry in general, it's worth checking into for a bit or looking into for a bit. And then if you stay, you stay. If you don't, you don't.
Well, I have nothing against your selection of The Eras Tour from Taylor Swift as a film. It was marketed a little bit differently, and part of the reason that you couldn't get a refund is because of the way it was distributed. Yeah. It's less AMC and more the Taylor Swift machinery that was going into that.
Right.
And it's been followed up by, I think, a couple of other films doing the same kinds of things. They're not quite four-walling it, but it's almost the same kind of thing where they are basically, you know, renting the theater for their own distribution as opposed to sharing it with the theater. So it's a different experience. I think it looks phenomenal. Mm-hmm. If I was at that show, I would be incredibly impressed. My daughter and I went to see the movie. She is actually in the damn movie. For a second, because she was at the shows that were there. I did not notice her, but she and her cousin went to those shows in Los Angeles that got recorded for the movie, and apparently there's a scene early on where they had good seats, so they show up a couple of times. I did not notice her. We're living in a Taylor Swift moment, apparently. Person of the year, you know, fantastic success with her musical releases, huge financial success with this particular movie. She's, you know, quite the phenomena that's going on here. And I think that if you were missing out on the phenomena and want to understand it a little bit, this is a good place to see it. Yep. I think she's very creative. I have a little bit of a problem with a couple of the things that the way it's shot in the movie, which is probably only a problem for me and not for anybody else, because it just seemed like there was some very repetitive kinds of shots. Mm. But if you're at a concert, you're going to see a lot of things that are sort of repetitive. So it's a little bit awkward, but not a bad thing.
I read an article that said that this type of show is going to be the salvation of movie theaters. This is the future of movie theaters. And I thought that was very interesting and made sense. You know, that's going to bring people into the theater where movies don't always do it.
Yeah, and I think in the UK as well, the tickets are priced differently.
I think I remember every ticket was it £19.89 for all of them?
Something like that, yeah.
Wow.
It is still that.
Yeah. They said a Beyonce film as well. Yes.
And I see even with a like SeaWorld Unlimited cards, it's the exact same price for everyone, no matter what.
Yes, there was no discounting whatsoever.
So, well, we definitely have a film that's interesting to talk about, not only because of its artistic qualities, but because of the cultural context in which we live. Howard, what's your number three film?
Probably the most polarizing one on my list. And that is Bo is Afraid, Ari Aster's film with Joaquin Phoenix. Oh, never mind.
We'll come back. Apparently, it's not quite that polarizing.
Controversial, yeah.
Tony.
Well, number three is on this being Pineapple Kiosk already, and that is Past Lives.
Yes, let me see, who had that? Rishabh had that, so go ahead. Well, let's start with Rishabh, since he had it on his list first, and then we'll come back to Tony, and anybody else who's seen it and wants to talk about it can add their two cents too.
Yeah, I think I had it the lowest out of everybody. I had it at number 8, which I think accurately it kind of describes where I am about it. I did really enjoy this movie. I saw it twice in theaters. It's definitely a movie you want to share with other people and show them, right? Because I think it's garnered a lot of the traction that it's gotten via word of mouth. I mean, people constantly are talking about it, around me at least. It's this very meditative, thought-provoking, kind of lyrical, poetic movie about two childhood friends who reconnect at various times in their lives. And it really captures themes of identity, destiny, free will. I mean, all of these things together in one movie, which is quite, in a surprising way, where it's very much centered around three people and their kind of romantic relationships and how they're kind of pulled together via just life and destiny in a way that's kind of compelling and surprising. And I did enjoy the focus on identity here. Obviously, there's all the characters. Two of the characters have a Korean background, and they're coming in from various places. I think the main character, who's played by, Greta Lee. She plays this character named Nora, who has a kind of a mixed background in her life. She's moved from Korea to Canada and then to Canada to the States. And it's left a big impact on the way she sees life, the people around her. And when somebody does come back to her life, it's kind of trying to catch up on a lot. And I think there is a lot of that nuance in the movie that is put in by the director. And it's a bittersweet, tender movie, very perceptive, and I had it at number 8.
All right. Tony, did you have some different thoughts about it?
Yeah, I mean, for me, just all these ones highlight the I think something that's been a bit overlooked about the film that I'm really impressed by was the music, which adds bittersweet feeling to it. The performances are all excellent, and especially from Greta Lee to you, that dynamic that those two have is excellent. And especially when you get to that final scene, I don't really want to spoil, but the final scene and just the lack of dialogue there and the way those two perform that scene, it's just a real heartbreaking and usually bittersweet moments between those two that makes it just really and the perfect capstone to the film. And just has that idea of the what could have been that's raised around it. And it's just a very emotionally mature film. Like, you can, like, even some of the dress, you can imagine, like, John Bergara's character being this more obviously villainized in any other film. But does it more intelligently and makes it a more, like, mature film. And the way he plays around with the use of language as well, so switching between English and Korean for certain scenes, and the idea of deliberately invoking a language barrier for moments of privacy, I found it to be a really interesting idea I've not really seen before, and this works this really beautiful bittersweet film.
Anybody else want a bite of the apple on this?
Yes, I will as well. So another thing I wanted to mention is just in terms of how it actually utilizes its locations as a character. So you see various scenes of Korean streets, and some of them with inclines or standing outside a doorstep at a home and having an intersection, also connected with the way that each of the characters may make decisions in their lives as well, to go in one direction or to go in the other. Then when you are in New York, you can see various sites. So they're along the ferry on Staten Island, and you can see the Statue of Liberty and also various areas of New York as well. And it really showcases those elements, also just showing those differences in the cultures too, and the characters' approaches to those different locations, and whether they embrace those new modern aspects and ideals or cling on to the traditional elements, which I thought was really well done in the film.
Terrific. Well, Latoya, it's your turn. What do you have for us in this number 3 spot?
So my next film on the list is Anatomy of a Fall. Okay.
I seem to remember that was coming. Yeah. My number 3 film is something that got Pineapple Kiosk earlier. Let me see. I'm trying to remember who had it on their list. I guess it was Howard. The Holdovers.
Yes.
And I don't think does anybody else have The Holdovers higher on their list?
No. Honorable mention.
then this is where we're going to talk about it, and we'll come to Anatomy of a Fall when we get to it on Howard's list, I think. So, Howard, do you want to start on the holdovers, and I'll finish up?
I just think it's a very well-made film that's very moving, surprising at times, and it just has great performances. I said it was a feel-good movie that gave feel-good movies a good name. I suppose in many ways it doesn't really take the art of cinema any further, but it's just a very good, very well-written movie with fine acting.
Yeah, I like the movie for a couple of reasons. The acting is terrific, and I think that it's a solid story. It takes what is a very standard format for films, boarding school students and contentious teachers, puts them together. But I thought that the results were very different than you might expect, and I thought they did a very nice job kind of creating an atmosphere that really reflected the time period. This is, you know, 1970, and we've got the Vietnam War going on. We've got a different kind, you know, a little bit of the hippie atmosphere poking its nose around the corner. We've got issues related to civil rights that come up, and I think that they did a nice job kind of mixing all those things without making it about those things, but just making it fit into that time period. And Paul Giamatti is terrific in the movie. The other actors are wonderful as well. What's her name?
Joy Divine Randolph.
Yeah, I'm getting the names inverted here. She's terrific. She steals the movie in every scene that she's in.
It also has my favorite line of the year, where he says, "I can't fail this course," and Giamatti says, "Oh, don't underestimate yourself. I think you'll find that you very well can."
I think I've used that line myself.
Yes.
On people. All right, number two, Rishabh.
All right, number two, and I was very happy to hear that Howard liked this movie. That's very validating. In a world where everybody hated this, it is Beau Is Afraid, Ari Aster's latest. And the tagline for this movie, I think, should be, "Don't recommend this to Richard." Because it has, I think, every element in this movie is things that would not fly by Richard. But I really did enjoy this one. It's kind of a dark horror comedy, or at least a dark comedy, that's quite different from his previous films, Hereditary and Midsommar. And I felt that of the three of these movies, this was his strongest. I mean, Astor always kind of had a penchant for this sinister sensibility that can go into some things that are quite transgressive and maybe even a bit uncomfortable. But Beau Is Afraid, which stars Joaquin Phoenix as the titular character, is just about a guy trying to get to his mom's house. But things get interesting on the way. I mean, it's clearly a three-hour epic. It's dark, disturbing, and very surrealist. There's a lot of sequences that are told in a somewhat of a non-linear, non-organized fashion, you might say. It's a bit of a jigsaw puzzle. But the movie comes together in a really fascinating way. It focuses on, it has its foundations in surrealism, absurdism, classical tragedy, dark humor. And I felt it borrowed some pages from Ingmar Bergman, I mean, the Swedish director, his kind of sensibility in terms of it being very surrealist, focusing on things that are happening in the subconscious. And I mean, it's really up to your interpretation whether the events of Beau Is Afraid are actually happening or not. I mean, I would think a lot of them are not, as a lot of it seems to be in the head of the character. But this is something that has a very schizophrenic kind of feeling to it. But it comes together in a really interesting way. I think it revives this kind of long-lost syntax of surrealist art house movies. And Ari Aster does it with a lot of vigor and intelligence, adding a lot of conviction to it. And I think most importantly, there's a character in here named Birthday Boy Stab Man, so I don't think I really need to say any more than that.
Oh, I like that. Birthday Boy Stab Man.
Yep.
Howard, I know that you talked about this film earlier this year, and I don't remember much of what you said except that you were enthusiastic about it, and you had it number three on your list, so what have you got to say about it?
Well, I'm not sure I can improve on what's been said. I'm not an Ari Aster film. I didn't like Hereditary. I didn't like Midsommar. but he has sort of set up this structure where he can get away with almost anything. And you can't really question it because it says, well, this is the world this character lives in. So I don't necessarily have to, you know, be that logical or that. It is very surrealistic. It is just completely surrealistic, postmodern. And Joaquin Phoenix gets my Best Actor of the Year award. And most people find it long, which it is. It's long. But becomes dull toward the end. And I had this very odd reaction, which only happened a couple of times. In the final fourth, because it's divided into four sections, I'm going, when will this ever end? While at the same time going, I hope this doesn't end at the same time. So, it's a very polarizing film. And I really, really loved it.
Does anybody else have thoughts? All right. Well, we'll keep our thoughts to ourselves then. Howard, what's your number two film?
Anatomy of a Fall. Somebody else. Pineapple Kiosk. That seems somebody.
I think this is the high spot for it, so I think we can go ahead with this.
I talked about this on the last show, and it's just a fascinating murder mystery in a way. In fact, it's surprising because it's really just about whether this guy fell or was pushed or jumped, actually, from the third floor of a chalet in a remote area of France in the mountains. But it just doesn't always go the way you think it's going to go. Sandra Hüller gets my award for Best Actress of the Year. She is just amazing here. This is, I think, the third thing that I've seen her in, and she is just a wonderful actress. And the court scenes that take place are really quite fascinating. If you want to see the difference between the U.S. courts and French courts, this will tell you. And as I said, I'm not saying one is any better than the other, but they are quite different. So I just found it a fascinating film.
Well, Latoya is our Francophile here, and she also had it on her list in the number three spot. Latoya, what did you think?
Yes, so I will echo just how good this film is. It really scrutinizes the courtroom and the dynamics within it, the dynamics between the lawyers, how they also interview the defendant, complainants as well. It looks at also how women defendants are treated by the media and also in the courtroom by prosecutors. Sandra Hüller is superb in it. The cinematography is really good as well with the snowy setting. And there's a really good needle drop as well off 50 Cent's song PIMP. So it is really one of the highlights that came out last year.
I was looking for it this week. I just didn't have time to see it because after having heard about it last week on the show, I said, of the things that we talked about last week, that was the one I most wanted to catch up with. I just haven't been able to catch up. So once again, you guys have encouraged me. I can't wait. Tony, what's your number two film?
Firstly, just going back to Anatomy of a Fall for a second.
Oh, sure.
Firstly, I would say it's a brilliant film, but also responsible for one of the worst cinema experiences I had last year. And my cinema did an advanced screening of it as a like secret screening. And he didn't put have the subtitles. And quite a lot of people went out to complain, and all of a sudden started saying, "No, we've got the print that is. It doesn't have subtitles." And so basically, everyone left. While I was still going on because,
there's in English as well.
It's
German and English, I think.
And French, but.
But there are subtitles, they just didn't have the subtitles.
Yeah.
Very strange. sometimes these, you know, there's a tech issue that goes on that's hard to explain. I was never involved in theatrical distribution, so I don't know everything that goes on there. I had a weird experience with this many, many years ago. We went to the movies, and my wife and I, she walked out of a movie that I was watching. I was watching the David Lynch film, Lost Highway. Mm-hmm. And she just said, I can't stand this. And she says, I'm going to go see something else. And she went to see a Clint Eastwood film that was playing down the hall, and it was in French. And they didn't have any subtitles. And she said, I didn't know Clint Eastwood spoke French. I said, I don't think he does. So it was a strange experience, a very, very surreal when that kind of thing happens. I also saw The Triplets of Belleville many years ago, and they had the reels mixed up. And we saw, the third or fourth reel in the second or fourth reel's place. They were inverted, and it was just like, what the hell happened here?
Yeah, now, that happened with a Henry James book, where two chapters got exchanged, and for years... literary critics have tried to justify it that Henry James did this on purpose, and they were going out of their way to figure it out. And some guy who was not a literary critic, who was just a college student, figured out that it had gotten mixed up when it was published in the U.S. and they had switched chapters.
Somebody just screwed up.
Yes, and it just made the story made sense after that.
Well, let's see if Tony can make sense of whatever he has in the number two spot.
Yeah, my number two, and I already know that this is a film that one other person on this podcast isn't a fan of, and it's going to be by film that was released in the UK in 2023, but it's outside all countries in 2022, and that film is Women Talking.
Oh, yeah. Okay, go ahead, Tony.
So, yeah, for me, so granted, I first watched this in... at the London Film Festival in 2022, which also had the little introduction from the cast and Sarah Polley. For me, I found this to be a really intelligent film about, you know, that focusing on the nature of forgiveness, the idea of what actually does it mean to forgive someone? Can it be true forgiveness if it's coerced? How does the psychological impact that they're giving themselves about what necessarily constitutes forgiveness and how they kind of just can kind of justify it in themselves to be, and some people can justify doing horrific actions on the expectation that they'd have to be forgiven, that they genuinely feel like they wouldn't experience any true consequences for their actions because of a society that wouldn't necessarily punish them, that wouldn't consider it to be anything serious as long as the crimes are forgiven. And all the discussions that happen in the film to support these ideals and the questions that are raised are all really fascinating to watch. I mean, granted, I feel like some of it can be a bit stagey at points, but I found that the whole direction, the scripts, and actually the performances really help add to it. It's like Rooney Mara, Claire Foy, Jesse Buckley, Ben Whishaw, all great stuff. You've got great character actors in the supporting roles. And even interesting ideas on gender identity and those kind of questions about how a more conservative patriarchal society views the changing gender roles in society and how people would accept the acceptance of different gender identities, and also the question of breaking the cycle of abuse and these regressive attitudes that we actually presented through Ben Whishaw's character and the idea of the minutes for the conversations being taken being noted down for a society that cannot read, women that aren't having been taught how to read. But how those limits are used can be used to break the cycle, to provide education on to the next generation, to help show why these conservative patriarchal ideas are so bad and how they need to be broken. and a lot of it does come from, especially with Ben Whishaw's performance. A lot of these like signs, the more saturated color palette to it, I found really works in adding to the a more bleak feel of the story. And also like little moments of levity that help establish this community and the bond that all the women have together. And also really appreciated, and again, there's one person whose name I'm never quite sure how to pronounce, who pronounced it right, Hilda Gunnarstier. Her music throughout the film I found to be excellent throughout, really creating this really bittersweet feel to it, especially at the ending and the decision that the women take. And I just found this to be really pretty haunting and engaging and intelligent film.
And I didn't find it that way. It was not for me, and that was basically what I said when I reviewed it. I said, it's not for me, and I felt a little bit like if I expressed opinions about it, I would be stepping on other people's right to have their opinions about the movie. So I just, you did say something, though, that reminded me it is a little stagey, and that was part of the problem that I had with it. But I'm sure other people on the show have something to say about it. That'll teach me to be sure.
Well, I never got around to seeing it myself. For whatever reason, it's one of those films.
Well, Tony and I would have different opinions about whether or not you made the right decision.
I did.
Go ahead, Latoya.
Well, for London Film Festival, and I really enjoyed it. I thought it's very well written, given that most of the impact is felt through the dialogue and taking place in one setting within this microcosm, and how the women feel. We know that there has been violence directed towards them, but it's off screen, and so all of that was really powerful. And then seeing the difference in their personalities shine through, and how they actually then decide to tackle the issue at hand, and all of their own considerations come to the fore. And so there is some conflicts between the women, and all of that power dynamic is really well filmed. And then you just see for most of the film that there's the absence of men aside from Ben Whishaw. And so all of that is really quite refreshing and really well done, I thought.
All right. Latoya, what's your next film?
So the next one on my list is a Lithuanian film called Slow. Okay, no one's seen that one then.
Nope.
Yes. So it is directed by Marija Kavtaradze. Whilst it's billed as a romantic film, it takes a more realistic viewpoint and portrays a couple having to explore different ways to be intimate in their relationship, as one of them is asexual. And so it basically questions what is intimacy and how a relationship progresses and how you develop all of that alongside the characters developing themselves in terms of assessing their own needs against their needs as a couple, and whether love in itself is enough, does there need to be other elements, and looks at their careers as well. One of them is a dancer, one of them is a sign language interpreter, and how they have different ways of communicating through the type of work that they do. And there is a lot of emphasis placed on communication and how important that can be when you're facing a non-conventional relationship. And it's really well filmed. It is quite immersive. You do find that as a result of that style of filming, that you may be drawn towards one character over the other. So you might be team, I think her name was Eleanor, or team for the man. And it really draws in those emotional aspects well, but will also make audiences pause and reflect in terms of how their own interpretation or reaction in a situation like that may be.
Well, it sounds quite intriguing. I'm interested in the issues of communication that you're talking about when relationships are developing or decaying. The kinds of intimacy that people develop include, you know, physical intimacy, of course, but you have emotional intimacy and intellectual intimacy that are also part of any relationship, and whether or not people balance those things out appropriately, that's typically explains why some relationships fail and others succeed. So I'm intrigued by it.
Yes, and I think it will certainly attract people that liked the film The Worst Person in the World, where you are looking at all of the nuances, people actually developing as well whilst they're in a relationship, and a film that's unafraid to explore the messiness within relationships, and also that people may not be certain or know how they want things to develop because they themselves are also developing in the midst of it all.
And nobody else has seen this, right? So nobody else has an opinion to voice. Fair enough. My number two film is a small little film that probably nobody has heard of. It comes from a filmmaker that is relatively obscure and probably the outlier on the show today. It's Oppenheimer.
And that's my number one.
Pineapple Kiosk.
All right. All right. So we will have it on the list here. Lynn, let's since Rishabh, you are next, and you have it at the top of your list, we can start talking about it. And Tony, you have it at the top of your list as well?
Yeah.
Okay. So let's go ahead and do this now.
Perfect. Yeah, I can start off, and then I'll hand it over to you, Tony. I'll keep it brief. I like how Richard referred to it as the little small movie that we all knew was going to be on our list at some point. It's Christopher Nolan's big opus, the biggie this year, based on the novel American Prometheus and the life of J. Robert Oppenheimer, who has made basically humanity's most defining invention, I would say, and I think this movie makes a strong case for that tag. It's a big, towering cinematic achievement for Christopher Nolan. It's psychologically, thematically charged, and it's a great telling of Oppenheimer's life in a way that is quite comprehensive of various aspects. It's not just focused on the Manhattan Project and that aspect of it, but his life overall. And of course, I love the interactions he has between him and Louis Strauss, played really well by Robert Downey Jr. I think that's one of the most politically pointed aspects of the movie. And surprisingly quite timely, I think, given the sphere of how things are politically in our world, I would say at large today, there's a lot of division and polarization, goes without saying. The fact that we have a reminder of people like Louis Strauss and how they can kind of manipulate things through bureaucracy to make it seem one way or another is a great example of the importance of perception in politics. So I think that beyond just being a biopic, I think Oppenheimer is not just a wonderful spectacle created by Christopher Nolan, who, you know, uses his spectacle level of sensibility to create something that turns it into a spectacle of emotional and moral weight, but it's also something that has a lot of timely themes for all of us today, and it's quite thought-provoking. I think, everything that's already been said about Oppenheimer in the world in this past year pretty much reflects my thoughts on it, and I think it's one of Nolan's most important and towering achievements.
Tony, thoughts?
What's already been said, I just want to highlight also of all the questions, the idea of objectivity and subjectivity, like through the two different color palettes using the black and white for what's in at the start. You feel it's more of an objective viewpoint of Oppenheimer, someone viewing it from more of a new, less biased background. But then as the film goes on, you start to see that it is more of a biased perspective, clearly biased perspective, and especially the question of is there ever such a thing as true objectivity, or whether it's everything can be fully subjective. I feel like in terms of the technical aspects of the film, so I went to see this at the BFI IMAX in London on 70mm print, and just the way it looks, obviously stunning, but it's the sound design that I really want to highlight as well, like the way that knowing when to use silence, especially during the Trinity test. I mean, you go mostly silent, just hearing that bit of dialogue from Oppenheimer, and then saving the big loud shockwave until after, for a while, so we give it this extra hit of impact. After all, it just gives this extra sense of weight to it. Performances are excellent. Like I mentioned, Robert Downey Jr. is great. Cillian Murphy is excellent. You know, great stuff from Matt Damon. I feel like you also get great stuff there as well from Jason Clarke and Josh Hartnett, Dave Krumholtz. A bit of scenes here at some points from Tom Conti's Einstein, and I think Christopher Nolan's probably the only director I can think of nowadays who could make a $100 million film as a summer blockbuster about serious nuclear physics and have it be this massive blockbuster hit.
No, I think that's true, and it's also surprising. It's not the kind of subject that you think, oh, this is exactly what I want to see in the middle of the summer, and have audiences line up for it, and combine it with the Barbie release, and it turns into kind of a summer phenomenon. You go, really? Is that how that's going to work? And for some reason, it did. And I think it's because Christopher Nolan has a reputation among people who are film fans, and they look forward to what he produces. I have this very high on my list, and it's funny because I went back and looked at my review, and I have a lot of criticisms of the movie. In my summary, I said the film's overlong, overpraised, but it's still a great achievement, despite the fact that it's sometimes being, pumped up so much. I think that there is so much technical stuff in this film that is well done, and obviously Nolan has serious themes whenever he is talking about a film and working on one. He's very proficient at finding things about the story that are important for us to see, but there's also a lot of stuff that I think kind of trails off in a variety of directions, and maybe it could be a little bit more focused, but the technical aspects of the movie are phenomenal. So did anybody else want to chime in on Oppenheimer? We lost Rishabh, by the way, who told me he had a hard out at 11:30, at 1:30 our time, my time. And so I'm sorry that we didn't get a chance to say goodbye to him, but I am glad that he got a chance to talk about his number one film before he left.
I didn't really care for the film all that much for a variety of reasons. One is that the women characters aren't very well drawn. They're very badly drawn. They're just not very interesting characters. And so I didn't think that aspect worked. The other issue I sort of had was the last third, where part of the story where it all revolves around Oppenheimer, whether he's going to get a security clearance taken away from him, and the Robert Downey Jr. character, whether he's going to be appointed some minor, or what I call a consolation prize cabinet position. I mean, he just wanted this position, and I'm going, are you kidding? That's the kind of position you get when you can't get the good ones. And in addition to that, I take away Oppenheimer's security clearance. I don't want him to have security clearance. So I wasn't sure how I was supposed to feel about things, but I couldn't take Robert Downey Jr.'s serious, his character serious at that point, because it was, to me, such a ridiculous conflict. And also the conflict over the security clearance. I'm going, well, there's no conflict. You can't give it to him. You gotta take it away. I do think Robert Downey Jr. is great. I think he gives an incredible performance, and he may finally get his Oscar.
All right. Well, we're talking to you, Howard. What have you got as number one on your list?
Okay. We talked about this on the Lambcast before. Asteroid City.
All right.
I'm not always a big fan of Wes Anderson. I think his movies often are style over substance, or that he makes some mistakes in either casting or structure, things like this. I thought this was incredibly beautiful and touching film. It, along with Spider-Man Across the Spider-Verse, are introducing a new era of thematics and aesthetics in film called metamodern. And what it is it's a combination of this aesthetics and structure and cynicism of postmodernism combined with the humanity and optimism of the modernist period. I just thought it was beautifully made. It looks great. The acting, though, you know, he has a certain style of acting where everybody really downplays everything. Worked very well here. It had a great set of actors. And I liked the play within a play idea. I thought that was actually rather brilliant.
Yeah, I remember our conversation about this when the film opened, and I like the film quite well. I'm not sure why it didn't end up on my list, because a lot of the things that you've mentioned are things that I appreciated very much in the film. I am a Wes Anderson fan. I think there's maybe one or two of his films that I haven't seen, but out of the more than dozen movies, I've seen the vast majority of them, and I can't think of one that I outright didn't like, and there are several that I really liked a lot, and this one would be included in it. Latoya, how about you? What's your last film?
My last one is a British film called Rye Lane.
Honorable mention for me.
Yes. And this one just epitomizes joy. It is such a colorful film, positive. It showcases areas of London in South London, and utilizes that walk, talk, fall in love style of film that you'll see in Before Sunrise, and just has a really good dynamic between the two central characters as well, as they go through a day or two in South London. They meet up, they go to art galleries, they go to karaoke and open mics and confront exes and provide that support for each other, and just really showcase a really positive element with joy and black love and London. London is the central character, and there's some interesting characters as well who also pop up in small parts, and yes, it's just a really lovely film.
Tony, you sound like you've seen this and liked it too.
Yeah, I thought it was just really great romance, like a lot of the chemistry between Vivian O'Hara and David Johnson. That those two have, it's just really great chemistry that the two have. It's and just help a lot of the benefit for romance film is it lives all eyes on the chemistry between the leads, and those chemistry is excellent and really makes film work. It's just great seeing all these different areas of London that don't really get the love that they really normally do in films. Like, you can definitely see this, like, there's all the little trivia you mentioned, like the before films you mentioned, and also that's actually a little fun little cameo appearance from Colin Firth, like seeing tributes to Richard Curtis as well. And also seeing like other like great talents as well, like even just like little appearance from Levi Roots just adds a lot of character to this film. Seeing people like Omari Douglas and Gary Beads and the Munya Chihuahua all just adds to this just fine film, and just the style that director Rain Alan Miller and the cinematographer add to it. Just this vibrance and colour and life to the film, and it just makes this really great romance. This has been number 11 on my list.
Well, I'm sorry that we missed Matt, because he had this on his list as well to talk about, and I had never heard of it before, and now we've got two people on the show who are enthusiastic about it. One's got it on their list, the other has it close to being on their list, and the one person that had to drop from the show because he had laryngitis had it on his list as well. So this sounds like quite a recommendation from people, and I'm glad that we've got that film on our discussion list here. That's very good. Well, I'm trying to finish off the show a little more quickly. We've gone a lot longer than I expected to go. My number one film is an outlier for a lot of people. It's called Guy Ritchie's The Covenant. And they only used the director's name in it because they didn't want it to be confused with some other film that was called The Covenant. Guy Ritchie is the director. It's a completely different kind of film from most of the films that he makes. It's not a gangster film. It's not stylish in the way that humor is used. And Jason Statham isn't anywhere to be seen. So it lacks those elements. But it is an interesting story. It's an important one. And it talks about what is in essence the betrayal of the American military and political system to their allies in Afghanistan, and the attempt by one person to sort of correct that. It's based on a true story, so what the elements of that true story I don't know are, but to me there were very harrowing action scenes in this movie. It was a very tight and tense film at times. We have two people who don't particularly like each other, but it ends up that they are strongly committed to one another. And I thought that under the circumstances in which they're operating, that was an important story to focus on. And I thought it was really well made. It disappeared almost instantaneously when it was released, and I haven't heard anybody else talk about it. But to me, it was the best film I saw from the time I saw it until the end of the year. So I'm glad to recommend it at this point and hope other people will give it a chance. We're going to take a quick break for everybody to hear from a fellow Lambcasting Network show, but we're going to come right back with some top 10 lists from other people and our exit question of the week.
Hey, Jay, can I ask you a question?
Sure, Mark. Far away.
How come Carter's always sliding around in Deep Blue Sea?
Wow.
And how come Preacher has a bird in the kitchen?
I think...
Should Janice have won an Oscar for all that exposition?
Yeah, I mean...
Who did the sharks hate the most? How far did Jim travel underwater?
About...
Why do they keep calling Brenda Tower?
Mark, please, we've already covered all of these topics and many, many more on Deep Blue Sea, the podcast.
You mean the podcast where we analyze Rennie Harlan's 1999 masterpiece, Deep Blue Sea, chapter by chapter?
Exactly! Find it everywhere podcasts can be found.
We're going to include a few films that were suggested by other people who are members of the Lamb community. I got three or four top 10 lists that I'd like to include in our discussion today. I'm going to start with Matt Hudson, who was originally supposed to be on the show but had to cancel because of laryngitis. His number 10 film is Anatomy of a Fall. Then at number 9, he had The Iron Claw. Number 8, Talk to Me. Number 7, Rye Lane. Number 6, Barbie. Number 5 is Oppenheimer. Number 4, Godzilla Minus One. Number 3 is Smoking Tigers. He says, Jae Yoon Yoo is fabulous in the lead here. Smoking Tigers is a relatively simple film, but one that just gets everything right. It's beautifully shot and wonderfully paced, smartly written, well acted, and has a strong emotional undercurrent. I absolutely adored this movie. At number 2, he has Spider-Man Across the Spider-Verse. And at number 1, he has Past Lives. Stefan C. sent a few films. His site is based in Romania, so some of his films are a little bit different. At number 10, he has Mamilia. Number 9, You Hurt My Feelings. Number 8, Reality. Number 7, The Goat and Her Three Kids. Number 6 is Close. Number 5, Passages. Number 4 is Oppenheimer. Number 3 is Rye Lane. Number 2 is Mission Impossible Dead Reckoning Part 1. And number 1 is Decision to Leave. And our buddy Paul McGuire Grimes wasn't able to join us on the show, but he did send his list as well. At number 10, he has Spider-Man Across the Spider-Verse. Number 9, Air. Number 8, American Fiction. Number 7, The Iron Claw. Number 6, Saltburn. Number 5, Maestro. Number 4, Killers of the Flower Moon. Number 3, Barbie. Number 2, Oppenheimer. And number 1, All of Us Strangers. We also had three guests who sent in voice recordings for their top 10 lists, so I'm going to give those to you now.
Hello, Lambcast listeners. This is Aaron Newworth. I am the co-host of the podcast Out Now with Aaron and Abe, and you can find everything I do at my personal blog, thecodeofzeke.com. I'm here to read my top 10 films of 2023. So before I get to that, let me go through a quick list of honorable mentions. And I'll just read them all out very quickly. Bo is Afraid, Poor Things, Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 3, The Holdovers, Past Lives, Rye Lane, Polite Society, Origin, They Cloned Tyrone, and The Boy and the Heron. Now for the actual top 10. Number 10, Wes Anderson's Asteroid City. Number 9, American Fiction, starring Jeffrey Wright. Number 8, David Fincher's The Killer. Number 7, 1001. Number 6, Anatomy of a Fall. Number 5, John Wick, Chapter 4. Number 4, Martin Scorsese's Killers of the Flower Moon. Number 3, that's right, stomping in, it's Godzilla, Minus 1. Number 2, Christopher Nolan's Oppenheimer. And number 1, Spider-Man, Across the Spider-Verse. Thank you very much, and I'll give it back to you, Richard.
Hello, Lammies. It's I, the Vern from Cinema Recall, here to give you my list of what I think were the best movies of 2023. Now, I'm only doing the ones that I saw in theaters, because if I tried to list the ones online and in theaters, the list got to be too huge, so I'm only doing the ones in theaters. So, right now, honorable mentions I have here is Saltburn, Asteroid City, Thanksgiving, Mathrigan, Suzumi, Spider-Man Across the Spider-Verse, TMNT, Mutant Mayhem, Spirited Away Live, Pi and IMAX, and Infinity Pool. So on to my list right here, the 10 best movies I saw in theaters in 2023. At number 10 is Oppenheimer. At number 9, Indiana Jones and the Dial of Destiny. I know this is on my worst list, but I loved it. I don't care. At number 8, Mission Impossible Dead Reckoning. At number 7, Sofia Coppola's Priscilla. At number 6, Polite Society. At number 5, Sanctuary. At number 4, Talking Heads, Stop Making Sense. I know this came out in 1984, but A24 released it wide in theaters in 2023, so I'm counting it still. At number 3 is Barbie. At number 2, Godzilla Minus 1, a really great blockbuster. And at number 1, it's Poor Things, directed by Yorgos Lanthimos, starring Emma Stone and Mark Ruffalo. It's a wonderful fantasy. It's funny. It's sexy. Yeah, love it. Anyways, folks, that's my top 10 of 2023. I hope you all have a great new year, and I will talk to you soon. Love you. Bye.
Hi, this is Jay Clurt from Deep Blue Sea, the podcast, and former host of this show, The Blamcast. My top 10 films of 2023. I've still got quite a few I need to see, and some didn't get released in the UK yet, or haven't been released here yet. My number 10 is Polite Society. A lot of fun, huge entertaining, way better than I thought it was going to be. Number 9, Mission Impossible Dead Reckoning Part 1. You can't beat those action set pieces, they're phenomenal. Number 8, Godzilla Minus 1. That's two films in a row ending with 1. In different formats. Godzilla Minus One is the only non-English language Godzilla film I've seen so far, and based on the quality of this, it will not be the last. Number 7, David Fincher's The Killer. Just like far funnier than you think it might be, and like stylish and cool and just a real good time. Number 6, a film I finished watching very recently, Sisu. Just a real straightforward story of a guy just trying to keep his gold and the evil Nazis trying to stop him from doing so. My God, this film does not hold back. If you haven't tracked down Sisu, watch it. It's worth your time. Number 5, Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 3. The Marvel film that's made me cry the most? Easily? By a long way? It's traumatic, it's heart-wrenching, but it's still like very entertaining. Number 4, a UK release for 2023 was The Fablemans, Spielberg's The Fablemans. Very, very self-indulgent, very autobiographical. But I'm a Spielberg fan, and that all worked with me. And it's got the best final scene of the year for me. Number three, another 2023 release for me was the Marcel the Shell with Shoes On. I never thought I would care quite so much for a little inanimate shell thing. It's, yeah, adorable. Number two, Spider-Man Across the Spider-Verse. So I can't wait to see this film again. So much going on in it. It's a feast for the eyes and all the senses, and I had a real fun time with it. And number one, my favourite film of 2023, was Wonka. Yeah, had a lot going against it. It's a Willy Wonka prequel musical starring Timothy Chalamet. That's kind of three strikes against it going in, but it blew away all expectations. Great songs, great comedy, great characters, all-star cast. Just utterly delightful.
Well, it's time for the exit question of the week, and our question this week is pretty simple. Since it's the start of 2024, what are you most looking forward to in 2024? What films draw your eye and make you interested? Latoya, you seem to see a diversity of films at all kinds of festivals. Is there something that's on your on your sights down the road that you are anticipating?
Yes, so I do have a few that I'm looking forward to. So there's The Book of Clarence. There is also Gladiator 2 and Ballerina. Rose Glass's next film, Love Lies Bleeding. A Quiet Place, Day One, Challengers, the new film about Bob Marley, One Love, Steve McQueen's new film, Occupied City, June Part 2, and whatever Jordan Peele's new film will be called as well. Always looking forward to one of his films.
All right, you get quite the list there. Lots of things to look forward to. Hopefully some of them will be great, and we'll be talking about them next year. Howard, how about you? A couple of things that you are interested in seeing down the road?
Well, first of all, I'm going to mention one that I'm not sure I do want to see, but for all those film aficionados out there, there is a movie called The Day the Clown Died that Jerry Lewis made and has never been seen. It's supposed to open in June of this year.
Wow.
Beyond that,
I haven't heard that. I hadn't heard about that.
Yeah,
that it was going to screen.
I've been seeing it on YouTube. So I don't know, you know, what's going to happen. I'm not sure I want to see it. But there are two that I've been seeing previews to, and they're silly. But for some reason, I really want to see them. Please don't judge me. The Beekeeper with Jason Statham.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, he gets revenge against some computer con men. And Argyle, Matthew Vaughn's new movie about a woman who writes espionage novels. And her latest one, which she doesn't have an ending to, apparently it's coming to real life. The things in the book just are happening at the same time as she writes them.
Well, Howard, I would never judge you. The Beekeeper is, a revenge film starring Jason Statham. I'm always there for those kinds of things. And Matthew Vaughn is one of my favorite contemporary filmmakers. I love the Kingsman movies and Kick-Ass. And Argyle would have been on my list, except that you just took it. So I'm going to insert something else.
You didn't do Pineapple Kiosk?
No, we didn't do that for this. Tony. What are you looking forward to?
So for me, there's ones I'm looking forward to, a few ones. Firstly, is it one I watched last year, but I'm really looking forward to rewatching, is the film Stop Motion. I'm pretty sure Shudder's going to be putting that on their streaming service. When I saw it at the London Film Festival last year, absolutely loved, really want to see it again. Other ones that I've got on my list, there's Dune Part 2, the new Bong Joon-ho film, Mickey 17, Furiosa, prequel to Fury Road, the Robert Eggers new version of Nosferatu, and the new Planet of the Apes film, Kingdom of the Planet of the Apes, Inside Out 2, and then probably my most anticipated film of the year is going to be more of an independent one, but it's someone who has hosted a podcast on the Wicker Man, who's someone who loves folk horror. My most specific one is going to be Starvaker, which is a new film from pronounce his name right, Daniel Cotangelo. I really loved his previous film, Apostasy. He's got a great cast with Matt Smith and Moffat Clark. Not really seen much about it. I've seen a few pictures and some of the stuff that came out when it premiered at London Film Festival, but that's the one I'm looking forward to seeing most this year.
Well, several of you have mentioned films that I'm looking forward to. Argyle and The Beekeeper would be two. Dune 2 is especially one that I am anticipating because I was a big fan of the first part, and I'm a big Dune fan to begin with. The film that I'm most looking forward to doesn't have a release date, but it is supposed to come out in 2024, and that's Maxine, which is the third film in the Ty West Mia Goth series, horror series. Moving the time period from the 1970s in X, the 1920s or early, you know, late 1919s in Pearl, up into the 1980s in Maxine, and it I think the first two films were my two favorite films of the previous year, and I have huge expectations for Maxine and can hardly stand it. That I have to wait. I don't know when it's coming out. There's no trailer. There's no poster. You know, we had a teaser at the end of one of the films, and I'm going, okay, let's have that now. And I've had to wait, and I feel that a little bit like a kid at Christmas time. When's Christmas going to get here? So that's the one I'm most looking forward to. Well, I want to thank everybody for joining the show today. I'm sorry we didn't get Rishabh's anticipated films. He had a hard exit for the show. And I appreciate everybody who sent in their top 10 lists. We'll add them to the show. And I think everybody will enjoy listening to our conversation here. I hope to catch up with all of you again soon. So I'm going to say goodbye to everybody. Thank you very much. And we'll catch you next time here on the Lambcast.
You've been listening to the Lambcast. If you have an idea for a show or would like to join us on the Lambcast, contact us at largeassmovieblogs.com.
Find us on Facebook, just search for Lambcast, or on Twitter, at Lambcast. The Lamb site can be found at largeassmovieblogs.com, and please head over to iTunes to leave us a review.
Go to hell.
It's over.